For decades, Penn State represented what was best about college athletics. For the past week, it has reflected what is often worst about human beings. And today, for the first time since late 1965, Joe Paterno will not be the head coach, and those in Beaver Stadium hope that they can aid in some small way in the healing process. Penn State and Nebraska from University Park. Dave Pasch will have the call.
And Reese, the Nebraska and Penn State players currently sharing the sentiments of many around the nation, gathering in prayer for the victims in these allegations, showing their solidarity and support. That's Nebraska assistant coach Ron Brown leading the prayer between the two schools at midfield. Otherwise, it certainly looks and sounds like an ordinary Saturday just before kickoff at Beaver Stadium, but of course, it is not. For the largest gathering of Penn State family members since the revelations began last weekend, those developments have left a wake of disbelief and heartbreak that continues to echo across the country. Emotions vary both in the stands and on the field. And that's where we head now to check in with Tom Rinaldi.
It's been a week nobody could have imagined here, Dave, at State College. The reach and scope of all that has happened has reached farther than anybody could have imagined. The question now is how far it may have reached onto this field as we're just moments away from kickoff. We've seen tens of thousands of students and fans enter the stadium here dressed in blue in support of the victims of these alleged crimes and the victims of child support everywhere. Child abuse everywhere. At the same time, the players have had to make their way through a tunnel, as they do so many places in college football, a passage darker and deeper than they ever could have imagined. Still at the end of it, there's a light, and in that light, there is a field. To get onto it, as Joe Paterno has said for decades, they cross a blue line, the blue line representative of all that Penn State is supposed to stand for. And when they step on the field, there's a game. That should be their focus. The game, Dave, is here.
Yeah, Tom, that's a blue line that we must cross as well. Chris Spielman with me here in the booth. And first, we want to send our thoughts and prayers out to the victims in these allegations. Also, Urban Meyer scheduled to join us in the booth as usual. Urban's father passed away on Friday. Urban, we're praying for you and hope you're back soon. Well, Chris, you and I have been here since Thursday. We talked with the coaches, met with them on Friday. We've seen the players. What's it like today?
Well, let's start with Thursday. And I didn't know what I was going to find when I went to practice, but I found a team that was energized and focused, not only the players, but the coaches. Now, on Friday, we met with the coaches. They were very emotional, but they were still into it, knowing that they have a responsibility to do their job, also a responsibility to their players, both on and off the field. And today, I just have the sense this, that Penn State is bigger than one person. It's bigger than one team. It's bigger than a few buildings. Penn State stands for something. It's a high standard that they have, and they're on the road to healing to get to that high standard right now.
Well, Chris, for the first time in a half decade, Joe Paterno is not the head coach at Penn State. Tom Bradley, in his 33rd year as an assistant, former player for Joe Paterno, is now the interim coach. What are the challenges that he faces today?
Well, Tom, his normal schedule was disrupted on Wednesday night. That's when he kind of plays his mock game. Goes through all his calls. Well, obviously, he took the job Wednesday night, so he's going to count on two of his defensive staff members, Larry Johnson and Ron Vanderlinden, to help him call the game. He's going to complete trust in his offensive staff to make sure those guys got it going.
Now, Tom Bradley has coached from the sidelines before, back in 2006 when Joe Paterno was out after injuring his leg and could not be at the game. Bradley coached that game from the sideline. Nebraska has won the toss and deferred, so Penn State will get the football. Jazz Powell will take a knee, and it will come out to the 20. There is still a Paterno on the sidelines today. Joe's son, Jay. Former player for his father, and in his 17th year as an assistant, normally upstairs, but with Mike McQuarrie no longer on the staff, placed on administrative leave. Tom Bradley telling us yesterday that he wanted to move Jay to the sidelines in what could be his final home game here in State College.
Also, you want that veteran presence on the field. With Mike McQuarrie not here, Jay brings that veteran presence and a sense of calm to his players.
There's a run play to the fullback, Joe Suey, on first down, and he gets a couple of yards. Brought down by Levante David, the leading tackler for Nebraska. And, of course, Penn State comes into this game undefeated in the Big Ten with a 5-0 record. Nebraska 3-2. They're in separate divisions. Penn State atop the leaders' division. Nebraska a game out in the legends. Silas Redd in the backfield, already over 1,000 yards rushing on the season. Third in the Big Ten in that category, but not much there. Able to power to the 26 for about 3 yards. It'll bring up third down and about four. Andrew Green made the stop for the Cornhuskers.
You know, I was on the field talking to some of the Nebraska staff, and I asked what happened last week against Northwestern. They explained it away by youth. This is a test for them. We saw them 2 weeks ago against Michigan State, quite frankly, dominate Michigan State. Now will they be able to answer the physical test that Penn State will bring to this game today?
Fourth year for Bo Pelini at Nebraska. They are 19th in the BCS standings. Penn State is 12th. And a third down and four. Matt McGloin, the starting quarterback. And he throws incomplete. He was trying for Justin Brown. So it's a three and out for the Nittany Lions.
You know, Matt McGloin is the starter. Tom Bradley, one of the big decisions that he makes as a head coach, we asked him, are we going to see an alternating quarterback system? He said, no, Matt McGloin's my starter. He will not come out until I tell him to come out. Right there, he had a bad decision. He could have ran that football for the first down, and Matt has to trust his feet along with his arm.
Yeah, Rob Bolden started the first 7 games, played in others, but may not play today. Coach's decision. Anthony Farrett, a punt. And And Amir Abdullah is the return man, and it's fair caught at the 36-yard line. Let's take a look at today's impact players, brought to you by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry. Taylor Martinez, known as a runner, but getting better as a passer. Six touchdown passes and just two picks the last four games.
And there you have Devin Still, along with the 15 and a half tackles for loss, also four sacks, a leader on the field, and maybe more importantly, I know more importantly, he's been a leader off the field, especially this week.
He's one of the 17 seniors playing their final game here at Beaver Stadium. On first down, Martinez will look deep and let it fly, broken up and incomplete. Kyrie Cooper, the intended receiver. And coverage by Nick Suke, another Penn State senior.
Well, I love the call by Bo Pelini to get Nebraska off and running early. And you see Suke coming in, taking a proper angle, laying out and making a play. But a good call, and that's basically to loosen up the Nittany Lion defense.
Here's Martinez getting dragged down from behind by Jordan Hill, the other defensive tackle, a junior who might be just as good as Devin Still on the other side.
When you have two studs inside in a 4-3 defense like Still and Hill, you have to pay attention and put two on one. Right there, Jordan Hill took advantage of the single block, beat his man-to-man, and was able to drag Martinez down from behind.
Martinez finds a man. It's Marlowe for a first down at the 47-yard line. A 14-yard gain and a first down for Nebraska.
Yeah, the new Taylor Martinez, over 70% last week. And here we see why. First of all, his footwork's good, eyes are downfield, and is throwing into windows. That's what he did not do earlier in the year. He would throw to a man right there. Good vision by Taylor to throw to a window, an open area, and trust his receiver will get there.
First attempt for Rex Burkhead, and he is cut down in the backfield by Drew Astorino. Burkhead comes in, Nebraska's workhorse, 951 rushing yards. He had 35 attempts in a game we had recently against Michigan State. We'll see if they lighten his load. That was his first attempt in play four of the day.
Yeah, he's out now. Some concern that he's hit that wall.
They go empty here on second and 10. Four receivers to the top of your screen. It's a design quarterback draw. And Devin Still eats up the quarterback for a loss at the 44-yard line.
One-on-one block, I would not. Why? Because he's great with leverage, great with his hands. Take a look. He recognizes quarterback draw, disengages, and a good secure tackle. You cannot single him because he will make you pay, as he did on that play.
One of the nation's leaders in tackle for a loss in a third and 13 now for Nebraska.
See if Devin's still here. He's got a little excitement, emotion. Let's see if he turns it on the pass rush.
Martinez, and it's through the hands of Brandon Kinney, incomplete. Kinney has struggled with drops this year. That one was right through his hands. It's fourth down.
It almost seemed like that defensive stand brought this crowd alive when Penn State had the ball in the opening series. It almost felt like, is it okay to cheer? And I think once they got that defense, that stop, maybe we'll get a little bit more life and energy into the stadium.
Brett Maher, one of the best punters in the nation, will boot it away from his 30. Penn State with two deep men, Justin Brown and Drew Astorino. That one almost got blocked. A terrific punt. And Brown maybe didn't know where he was in the field. He took it at the 5-yard line, and he does get it back out near the 20. No score, 4 minutes into the first quarter in University Park. No score at Penn State, 4 minutes gone by. Well, last night, thousands gathered for a student-organized candlelight vigil to support the victims in front of the old main administration building on campus. The crowd listened to speakers, including former Penn State linebacker LeVar Arrington. Now let's check in with the Fourth member of our crew down on the field, here's Lisa Salter.
Hey, Dave, well, I'm down here on the Nebraska sideline. And remember earlier in the week, Nebraska officials were very much concerned about their fans coming up here this weekend, their players coming here to play in this game, and with good reason, given that riot that erupted on campus on Wednesday night. Well, there are plenty of Nebraska fans here today, and I spoke to them, and I asked them about why they came, and they did admit that initially they were concerned. They weren't sure if it was the right thing to do, but as the week went on, they felt more comfortable, and they're here today. One thing I did see, Penn State student ambassadors personally greeting anyone wearing red, welcoming them to State College and to this game.
Well, Tom Osborne, the athletic director, had advised Nebraska fans to maybe not wear red out of concern for safety, but as you saw, a lot of Nebraska fans wearing the home colors. Here's McGloin to throw on first down, and in the middle of the field, it's pulled in. Allen Robinson, a true freshman, with a gain of 9. Impact players brought to you by Jared, the Galleria of Jewelry. So McGloin, now the starter, third start of the year. He started 5 of the final 6 games last year.
Yeah, the unquestioned leader and producer on the Nebraska defense, Levante David, he will make plays both in the run game and pass game.
Second and short, Stephon Green, a senior, is out there right now. And Green is knocked down, appears to be short of the first down. Will Compton on the stop. Galen Hall and Jay Paterno continue to call the offense. That's how it's been going, just with Jay now on the field. And Tom Bradley, the defensive coordinator, will call the defense, even though he's now the interim head coach. But at some point, Larry Johnson, Ron Vanderlinden, who were named by Bradley, co-defensive coordinators, will become more involved. And Green on third down and 1, trying to push the pile, and has the first down of the 30. Will Compton was there, but moved the sticks for Penn State.
Well, I like what Penn State is doing. I was talking to the coaches before the game. A little concerned. They know they were going to face an emotional team playing hard. And Penn State so far has come out and they look a little lackluster. But throwing on first down will help them. But Nebraska's been pretty physical to get this game started. And you see Jay Paterno, he's down there for a reason. He's a comfort level for Tom Bradley. Obviously, he's replacing Mike McQuarrie, the assistant who's not here. And Jay's a comfort level not only for Tom Bradley, but for his players.
McGloin off play action, gonna go deep, Moy, and he cannot come up with it. He dove at the 30, but could not make the catch. He had Andrew Green covering. Pressured by Baker Steinkuhler, but McGloin's pass was there for Moy.
Throwing on first down, loosens up the defense. They're doing this so they can run the ball later. Derek Moy missed a few games, back 100%. I love the call, and I love the shot. Derek Moy will make that catch 9 out of 10 times. He's that good. But that's just to keep Nebraska aware. We have something for you. You better play us honest.
McGloin out of the gun on 2nd and 10. And a wide receiver screen. And Stephon Green, who was lined up out there, and he's got 3 yards to the 33. And Levante David with another stop. So 3rd down and long coming up. You know, you're talking about Jay Paterno, and we asked Jay yesterday, did he consider stepping down after he found out that his father, Joe, would no longer be the head coach at Penn State? And he said no.
Well, absolutely not. I think that Coach Paterno, Joe, would be almost insulted that he would step down. He's trained to be a coach. When you're trained to be a coach, your players come first. Knowing Joe Paterno, there's no way that Jay would not have been here today.
There's McGloin to throw on 3rd down and long, and the pass is tipped and then caught. Curtis Drake inside the 40-yard line off the redirection.
Never give up on a play. You're going to see right here. Stay with the play. Stay with the play. Focus in. The pass was behind an underthrow. It's the old tip drill. We always talk about tip drill being for defense. Not right here. Offense, and good job of concentration and turning into rack yards right after you catch. Run after.
31 yards. Ciante Evans was the man that tipped it. And now Red, not much off the left side, maybe a yard. He was the leading rusher in the month of October in the nation. Silas Red. He got 2 yards there, so it'll bring up second and eight.
And Levante David did his job. Actually took a little bit of a gamble. Good linebackers, David. They trust their instincts and they'll gamble. Coming underneath his gap, beating his blocker underneath, but slicing in to make the play. He's an instinctive player. Watch him all day. He's fun to watch at that linebacker position.
Set the school record last year in Nebraska for total tackles. Second and eight for Penn State inside the 35, and it's a reverse. Shawnee Kersey, and Nebraska does a pretty good job with it. Andrew Green gets him down around the 31-yard line, so it's a gain of only three. It'll bring up third down and five.
Gain of three, that could have been a minus 10 if not for the block of Matt McGloin right here, Gideon Meredith. Space, but Nebraska, the one thing you know if you watch their defense, disciplined. They're very disciplined and well coached by Bo Pelini and Carl Pelini, and usually disciplined teams, it's tough to get them on those trick plays or misdirection plays.
State players in the same area. Pass was a little behind Allen Robinson. He could not hang on. So fourth down and five, and Penn State will bring on the field goal team. Do you like the decision here to go for three?
Absolutely. That means you have faith and trust in your kicker. And any time, if you're an offense that doesn't score a lot of points, we know Penn State doesn't. You're in the red zone. Get points when you can get points.
Well, Anthony Fair has only missed twice this year, but his long is just 40, and this would be a 47-yard try. And Fair's kick is no good. Led the Big Ten in field goal percentage prior to that. And Nebraska will take over with decent field possession after that missed field goal by Penn State. Nebraska 7-2, 3-2 in the Big Ten, dropping nine spots in the latest BCS standings after losing at home to Northwestern. So they are currently 3-2 along with Iowa and Michigan, a game back of Michigan State in the Legends Division. Penn State controls its own destiny in the Leaders Division. It can win it outright with two victories in its final three games. Still road games at Ohio State and at Wisconsin for the Nittany Lions. Nebraska from its 30-yard line. Martinez has to step away from pressure, and it's incomplete. He was trying for his tight end, Ben Cotton. That's the fourth pass attempt by Martinez in this ballgame.
A little late recognizing right there by Martinez, and also late by Ben Cotton. That was his zone. If Ben Cotton sits down, Martinez would have been right on target with that pass. Instead, he ran through the zone into coverage.
A lot of first down pass plays for Nebraska, which is unusual for them. Martinez throwing again, and in the middle of the field, a man was open. It's Bell, but he couldn't hang on. So that's two drops by Nebraska in between the hash marks.
Well, everything talks about Taylor Martinez and his struggles throwing the ball this year. He's found a new groove. But in order to be successful throwing the football, you need a little help to make a tough catch. This is a catchable ball. Kenny Bell needs to make for his quarterback and his team.
Martinez will go deep again, and it's overshot. Marlowe, the intended receiver, the pass was too high. Are you surprised by all the pass plays from Nebraska?
I'm not, because I'm not sure Nebraska has a lot of confidence in their running game, although they rush for over 200 yards a game. They're not even attempting to run the ball, and I understand why. Feeling that you have this front four of Penn State, which is as good as there is in the Big Ten and maybe the country, you want to try to loosen them up to be able to run the football and take advantage of that.
Maher to punt. Justin Brown is back. Penn State got close on the last attempt, and this one is out of bounds. We'll see where they spot it.
It goes out of bounds.
It'll be Penn State football at the 28-yard line.
Penn State 28-yard line.
And obviously, this is not just an ordinary senior day at Beaver Stadium here in University Park between Penn State and Nebraska with the developments of the last week. And well, that first seat on the first bus normally occupied by Joe Paterno was left empty. On the buses that come over to the stadium, Tom Bradley said he would take his normal spot on the second bus with the defense. McGloin on first down has a completion to Moy, and he picks up 11 to the 39. It's a Penn State first down.
The advantage of size at wide receiver. Derek Moy at 6'5" right here does the old basketball, just kind of box out, uses his body. And you have Green who cannot run through him, and Derek Moy is strong, but size is a huge advantage out there, especially on those slant routes, because you win the power battle and you can win jump balls.
Moy is fifth all time at Penn State and catches third in receiving yards. Inside run to Red, trying to get outside but can't. Wrestled down at the 43-yard line by Andrew Green. So three or four on the pickup, and it brings up second down.
Andrew Green's a player that struggled early the last two games. He's really turned it on. That's a good job. And again, misdirection does not fool this Cornhusker defense because they're well coached and they're disciplined.
Pellini is the defensive coordinator, Bo's older brother by 2 years. They gave up 468 yards of total offense and lost last week. Here's Red, and again, no running room. Downed by Compton. Maybe a couple of yards, so third down so far. McGloin, 4 of 7 passing. Do you let him throw it here in third and four? They have not been able to run it yet like they have in other games.
You've had receivers open, so yes, you let him throw it. Now, the problem, Ben, is McGloin has been off target. And this is a crucial third down, and this is where your number 11 has to shine. This is where you make a statement that I'm a starting quarterback. I will move the chains on third down. This is how you're defined.
And McGloin will throw, has time, and it's incomplete. There was some contact as Moy was being defended by Stafford, but no flag, and Penn State will punt.
Just a little option route by Moy, who again, who has the big body. Looked like there was a little contact underneath that knocked Moy off balance.
Almost looked like a push in the back, but no flag, and it's fourth down.
Both defenses answering the challenge and starting fast.
Farah to kick. Abdullah, a dangerous return man, has a kick return for a touchdown this year. He's not going to get a shot at this one, as this is airmailed into the end zone. A 56-yard punt. It will come out to the 20 for Nebraska. Still no score. First quarter at Beaver Stadium. Dave Pasch, Chris Spielman back at Beaver Stadium. No score between Penn State and Nebraska. With Tom Bradley now the interim head coach, Larry Johnson and Ron Vanderlinden are the co-defensive coordinators. We met with both of them yesterday. Johnson became very emotional, not just given the situation with Coach Paterno, but most of all for the victims in these allegations. And they're going to put Martinez in as a tailback and hand it off to Burkhead, or actually snap it to Burkhead, who's lined up under center. A lot of times we'll see Burkhead lined up in shotgun for a direct snap, but that time he went under center. That's one way to get your running game going. 7-yard pickup there at -4 rushing yards prior to that play.
Speaking of Larry Johnson, they were a little concerned about the traditional option game. And right there was the belly option. In order to stop that, you have to play assignment disciplined football. They're a little out of whack on the defensive side. It's a little different than the spread option, Dave. The belly option, blockers are coming at you from different angles.
And Martinez throwing complete, and a first down. Kenny Bell to the 32. Chris, in those meetings yesterday, we mentioned Larry Johnson was emotional. Anything else that stood out to you when we met with him or Jay Paterno, the other coaches?
Well, obviously, I mean, they have a tremendous amount of pride and belief in Penn State. And they felt like that it's their job to try to rebuild that trust and pride back in this university. It's a big burden they take upon themselves.
Here's Burkhead on first down. Can't get a seam. Tripped up at the 38 by Astorino. You asked him about recruiting and how this impacts recruiting. And you could tell that was another reason why they were upset, concerned with how their program is being viewed by prospective student athletes at Penn State.
Yeah, and they have to be able to be truthful and honest. When you look at the situation, these guys can't answer the question of whether they're going to be here or not next year. And they have to answer the question of trust.
Here's Abdullah getting the handoff and getting drilled. At the 37-yard line, Devin still in there again. Loss on the play.
Well, no one thing you can trust is number 71, Devin Still, playing in his last home game as a senior. Take a look. Again, we talk about what can't you do. They try to double team him enough, but Devin Still with the quickness and the quick arm over swim. That's instincts and technique. Well coached by Larry Johnson.
Martinez on third down, way off the mark, intended for Kyrie Cooper. It'll be another punt for Nebraska.
That's a misread right there by Taylor Martinez, or it could be a misread by Cooper. Cooper goes inside, Martinez throws to the outside shoulder. That's recognition, and usually that read is made by the position of the defensive back, not on the same page.
Another punt for Maher, and Justin Brown, Drew Astorino are deep. And this takes a Nebraska hop, and Astorino forced to scoop it up at the 8-yard line. And he gets walloped at the 16. Three of the top four teams in action tonight on the ESPN networks on ABC at 8 Eastern time. Pac-12 showdown, Andrew Luck and Stanford against Oregon. Were you surprised that Stanford was behind Alabama in the BCS standings? And can Stanford go to number three with a win tonight?
Yeah, I absolutely think if they beat Oregon tonight, they should make the jump. But I got to tell you, I mean, I'm just feeling upset right now. Ask me in a couple hours, but right now I'm feeling like Oregon's going to go in there. It'll be a great game and a great matchup.
Penn State ball in the 16, play fake for Matt McGloin. And his pass is caught outside the 20-yard line by Kevin Hapley, the tight end. Only his second catch of the year. It's a gain of 8 yards.
What we're witnessing is trust in a quarterback. Why, even though he's missed some passes, he keeps throwing the ball, meaning Jay Paterno and Galen Hall on first down. And that trust not only comes from Jay Paterno and Galen Hall, but it comes from the interim head coach, Tom Bradley.
See McGloin's numbers today, only a 56% passer, 7 touchdowns, 3 picks on the year. A pitch to Red on second down and short, and able to get outside and get the first down. He shoves a defender out of the way. Finally pushed out of the 30. It's a gain of 7 and a Nittany Lion first down.
Boy, watch this. Watch Curtis Drake. If Curtis Drake gets his block, this is still running to the sidelines. You see number 7, Curtis Drake on Denard. Tries to cut him below. Denard does a good job of playing with his hands. As you see Levante David, which you'll see all day, come over and clean up. But that's the importance of big plays happen run downfield, Dave, if receivers block downfield.
Another run play and room for Red. And Red able to spin away from a couple of would-be tacklers. Huge run play by Silas Red, a sophomore, who comes into this game 18th in the country in rushing.
It's not just 10 yards. What it is, it's a motivator for your offensive line. When they see you running like this, running through arm tackles, spinning, fighting, biting, clawing for anything you can get, you get in the huddle and say, I'm giving it to you, offensive lineman. Now you start giving it to me back.
That offensive line led by 4 seniors playing their final game here at Beaver Stadium. And a timeout called by Penn State. Play clock was down to 3.
Brazil's World soccer tour continues as they bring their beautiful game to Qatar. Watch as the five-time world champions take on the Pharaohs at the Al Rayyan Stadium. Don't miss Brazil, Egypt, this Tuesday, live on ESPN. The countdown to Euro 2012 continues.
What a goal!
Watch as Europe's elite battle for a coveted spot in the Euro 2012 finals. Don't miss Republic of Ireland, Estonia, this Wednesday, live on ESPN.
Penn State 5-0 in the Big Ten, getting great play from Devin Still, trying to lead the Nittany Lions to a Big Ten championship. They won it last in 08 and went to the Rose Bowl. This senior group, 37-11 record. And here's a pitch, Stephon Green, and he gets nailed by Andrew Green and shoved out at the 49-yard line, a gain of a handful.
Conceptually, a great play drawn up. They come to an unbalanced look. They bring three receivers to one side, empty receivers to the other side, trying to get everybody in defenses to rotate one way. But again, it's tough to do against a disciplined defense and a disciplined player like number 11, Andrew Green, who stayed home and made a good open field tackle.
See if they run a play here, and they will. With time running down here in the quarter, McGloin with time and gonna go deep. And Ciante Evans able to break it up. It was intended for Kersey, and Evans had a better chance at it. And that's the final play of the first quarter. Penn State has taken a lot of shots downfield. Ciante Evans making the play here for Nebraska. No score after one. Prior to today's game at Beaver Stadium, the players and coaches, Tom Bradley out shaking hands with everybody here in the stadium. And obviously an emotional day for many reasons here in University Park, Senior Day. The victims in the allegations, a lot of Joe Paterno fans. Paterno was to pass Amos Alonzo Stagg today for most games coach in Division I. McGloin on third down and five, trying to set up a screen. It's not there and thrown in the dirt. Incomplete, and Penn State will have to punt it away.
Will Compton sniffed that out. And a good decision by McGloin just to throw it away, live to fight another down. But that's a decision that you'd like to see. Will Compton, again, the discipline of Nebraska's defense. They're responding to the challenges and the difficult circumstances that they're playing in. But what we're seeing now is both teams settling in and defenses are dominating. Not a lot of energy in the building, though, Dave.
No, there was earlier. You're right. And is that because of what's going on this week or just because there's been no offense so far in this game? That punt hangs in the air and goes out of bounds. We'll see again where it's spotted.
Here's punt goes out of bounds.
And wow, Nebraska will have it around the 27-yard line. Well, the latest development yesterday was that Mike McQuarrie, the wide receivers coach and recruiting coordinator, was placed on administrative leave. He had been part of the Nittany Lion program going back to 1994 as a quarterback here at Penn State. He, of course, allegedly witnessed the sexual abuse of a minor by Jerry Sandusky when he was a graduate assistant. So he's not here, and Jay Paterno on the field in his stead playing that role of signaling in offensive plays. Flag down, Burkhead, and the dead ball foul. Actually, Martinez on the carry. Gerald Hodges on the stop. See what the penalty is.
Offsides. Defense, number 81. 5-yard penalty. Replay first down.
It's on Jack Crawford, first flag of the day. Chris, what about the players? All of a sudden, your coach is not there, McQuarrie, and your head coach is not there, Joe Paterno.
Well, I think you trust the coaches that are there, and I got to be honest with you. I mean, those are just voices during game day. When you cross the lines and you're playing the game, you're focused on your job and your teammates.
Martinez, well, he faked the pitch back, and he's close to a first down. Gerald Hodges there again, won the Big Ten Player of the Week award consecutive weeks. And it is a first down for Nebraska.
A little bit of a different look off the option. And again, in order to defend option football, you have to be disciplined. Somebody on a dive, somebody on the quarterback, somebody on the pitch. Taylor Martinez, good decision.
Here's Burkhead, drilled at the point of attack.
Number 22, Burkhead.
Sean Stanley
greets the running back Rex Burkhead for no gain.
Oftentimes the man who makes the play didn't make the play. And what I mean by that, Devin Still, number 71, penetration, creating havoc, knocking off pullers to free the pursuit from the backside coming up. Devin Still stepping up and playing like I expected him to play today.
Yeah, Jordan Hill in there again on that tackle along with Stanley. Second and long. Martinez waiting, and he'll keep. And an excellent decision. Boy, he pump fake twice and has another Nebraska first down of the 49.
Poise and trust is what I see in Taylor Martinez. Poise and no panic to pitch. Watch this, allowing his blockers to get out in front of him. And you see the poise. Don't pitch. Go ahead, keep it and get what you can get. But again, Penn State is being a little bit confused by the option of Nebraska, the triple option by Nebraska.
And now Martinez will throw, and it's complete to Cotton, his tight end. And Nebraska's inside the Penn State 40-yard line.
Seeing a different quarterback than I've seen. Did you see Cotton hurt with his holding his arm? But I'm seeing a different quarterback than I've seen a couple weeks ago. What I'm seeing is a guy that is confident throwing the football, standing tall, going through his progressions. First read isn't there. The second read's there. Instead of me tucking and run, bam, I'm throwing strikes.
So Cotton is down as Nebraska is into Penn State territory for the first time. Starting tight end for Nebraska, Ben Cotton, shaken up after that first down grab, getting Nebraska into Penn State territory for the first time today. His replacement is Kyler Reed, who has 10 catches last year at 8 touchdowns, so he's a viable target. Here's Martinez, and he's got a completion. Inside the 30 to the 25 is Kenny Bell. Stephon Morris on the tackle. 12-yard gain, first down.
Well, I can't get over the fact of Nebraska's game plan, and this has to catch Penn State off guard a little bit. Their whole goal is to come out and sling the rock.
Here they put Burkhead under center again. Second time we've seen this. And Burkhead running the option. He's gobbled up by Jordan Hill after a gain of a couple.
If you're Penn State, don't honor the pitch. You're not going to pitch it to Martinez. What it turns into is a quarterback follow. Basically, it's a lead play. They show the belly action. That's when a quarterback reverses out, fakes to the fullback, and just tucks in right behind him and uses him as a lead blocker. Don't even acknowledge Martinez as a tailback.
Only 16 yards on the ground for Burkhead. He came in averaging 106 yards per game. That's fourth in the Big Ten, 21st in the country. They fake it to Burkhead. Martinez in trouble, being chased by three Nittany Lions. Martinez able to get out of there, stepping out of bounds around the 26-yard line. Still a loss on the play of about three.
You see right here, they come with a five-man pressure, and they peel off on the blitz. And when you peel off, you usually lose offensive blockers, but there's no substitute for what Taylor Martinez also brings to the table, speed. This is testing Tom Bradley now. Remember, Tom Bradley's whole preparation was interrupted throughout the week, and they're getting something they haven't seen Nebraska do, where they're coming out throwing the ball all over the yard.
Yeah, remember them yesterday. He said, I'm behind in my preparation. Third and 11. Play clock at 3. Quarterback draw for Martinez, and he's dragged down after a gain of 3 by Jack Crawford. That'll make it a more reasonable field goal try for Brett Maher of about 40 yards.
Sure, Tom Bradley right there had that in his game plan because his defensive lineman responded well. Anytime they go empty with a running quarterback, especially with the skill of Martinez, alert quarterback draw.
Brett Maher, fifth in the country in made field goals. And inside 50 yards this year, he's perfect. 13 of 13. This is a 40-yard try. And he just sneaks it inside the right upright. 41 yards officially on the field goal. So Penn State misses a field goal try. Nebraska makes, and the Cornhuskers have the lead. Early second quarter on the road.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Lincoln. Get more than you wished for at the Wishlist event. And Applebee's new sizzling entrees. Fresh flavor never sounded so good.
An early second quarter lead for Nebraska, 3-0 over Penn State after a Brett Maher 41-yard field goal.
Brett Maher is on the kickoff for Nebraska.
Penn State with 107 yards in total offense, which for them for a quarter is good. They come in 100th in the country in scoring and 88th in total offense. But no points for Penn State because of a missed field goal. Here's Chas Powell on the return. And Powell makes one man miss, and another. Finally wrapped up at the 28. Let's go to the studio and check in with Reese Davis.
Dave, SportsCenter right now brought to you by Discover Card. This is a scene earlier this morning at Joe Paterno's house. Some fans in the early morning came by. You see some kneeling on the outside. Saw Sue Paterno leave the house earlier. So too, Jay Paterno, who's at your game coaching, obviously, but no sign of Joe Paterno today.
And Jay's son on the sideline, Reese, normally upstairs. Here's Silas Red trying to find a hole, and he gets swarmed after minimal gain at the 29-yard line. Now, Jay told us that he went over to his dad's house, had a good conversation with him. All the coaches went over and really didn't talk football. They did bring him a game plan just for him to see, but they really didn't talk football. Tom Bradley said that he called him, and Joe said, "Why are you calling me? You're fine. You don't need my advice. You'll be fine." Those were Joe Paterno's comments to Tom Bradley, the interim head coach. Play action. And McGloin, with tons of time, waiting for an open man, now throws it away. Let's check in with Tom down on the field.
Well, Dave, such an emotional week for the Paterno family. And this morning, Jay Paterno went by early to see his parents, Joe and Sue. Fearful that he might not be able to contain the emotions, he wrote a letter, but he asked that his parents not read that letter while he was there at the house. "Please read it later, after I leave, Dad," is what he told Joe. A letter to be read, basically giving him the message of what he means to him, what this day means to him. And I'm sure that letter's been read down the Paterno household, Dave.
All right, Tom. Here's McGloin on third down and long, stepping up, being chased by Compton. Dangerous throw, but it's caught by Moy. Penn State first down. Moy a factor through the air so far in this ball game with a couple of catches.
Well, this is why Matt McGloin's in the ball game, because he doesn't get frustrated by missed passes. Very good job throwing the fadeaway. Also with Derek Moy, he's going to run the crossing route. Watch him run the crossing route, recognizing his quarterback in trouble. The rule is work back, get open, give yourself space so your quarterback can deliver the goods, as McGloin did.
From the Penn State 44, first and 10. Silas Red cutting it back, and it's a good pickup on first down of 4 or 5. Cameron Meredith on the stop. Nebraska is light on the defensive line. Jared Crick out for the year. Suffered a torn pec muscle against Ohio State. Chase Rome, who you see there, number 97. He didn't play last week, but he's back out there today. They only go about 3 deep at the defensive tackle position.
And do a little bit of a 30 front, which is part of their normal package. And a 30 front is three down defensive linemen and 4 linebackers, which are in now with a guy directly over the center of the nose guard.
Here's Stephon Green, and he runs into his own man and gets a yard. Chase Rome made the tackle. Here's Lisa down on the field.
Hey, Dave. Well, the Paternos must be a letter-writing family. Matt McGloin told me that Joe Paterno sent a letter to the players, a short note, yesterday afternoon. That short note was read to players before practice. In that letter, it said that he was heartbroken, sorry he couldn't be with them, but he wanted them to focus on this game and not on him. Dave?
You know, there was some speculation, too. We asked the coaches about this, that if Penn State wins, the seniors might take the game ball and walk it down to Joe's house. We'll see if that happens. The coaches were unsure of the plan at that point. Here's McGloin, a little half roll on third down, and the pass is deflected by Alfonso Dennard, a preseason All-American who's been playing like one. He was great against Michigan State a couple of weeks ago and broke up the pass here.
Matchup zone, nobody does it better. than Nebraska. And anytime you can get your hands and have the awareness to avoid contact so you don't run through the back and deflect the ball, is an outstanding athlete, and you can see why he's highly acclaimed.
Anthony Farrah will punt it. And Marlowe, the deep man for Nebraska. Fourth and four. And a short kick that's fair caught at the 21. Midway through quarter number two at Beaver Stadium, it remains 3-0 Nebraska.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Nebraska in front of Penn State, 3-0 midway through the second quarter. The SEC takes center stage tonight with three games on the ESPN networks. On ESPN at 7:45, Trent Richardson and number three Alabama looking to rebound from the loss to LSU, taking on Mississippi State. Also Arkansas, Tennessee on ESPN2 and top-ranked LSU on ESPNU against Western Kentucky. Well, so far, very typical of how Penn State has played this year. Low scoring and good defense. Martinez throwing it out on the flat to the tight end Kyler Reed, and he is brought down at the 26-yard line by Chaz Powell. 4 or 5 yard pickup. Well, Penn State third in the nation in scoring defense, eighth in total defense. And as mentioned, they've been a lot of close games. They just beat Illinois 2 weeks ago, 10-7. We saw them here against Iowa win 13-3. Their only loss was to Alabama. They lost 27-11 in that game. Here's a pitch to Burkhead, finds a hole. And Burkhead out near the 37 before he's wrapped up, and he still pushes the pile. Got an additional 3 yards with that second effort. A 14-yard gain for Burkhead.
And what you're going to see is the guard pull and kick out, and Rex Burkhead shows that I have not hit the wall. No, I've got more juice in me. And one thing you'll get with Rex Burkhead is effort, effort, effort. And again, anytime a running back gives you that, the linemen get juiced for him.
Another carry for Burkhead between the tackles. And a pickup of five. Brought down by Jack Crawford. And now Burkhead will run to the sideline for a quick breather. Nebraska coming off a home loss to Northwestern. Their other loss was against Wisconsin. So they are a game back in the Legends division. Their last conference title was 1999. Last BCS Bowl was the Rose Bowl as a member of the Big 12 back in 2002. They're still in line. Got to win today, though, as that pass was forward and incomplete, intended for Bell. So it's third and five. Another misfire by Taylor Martinez. 5 of 12 passing now.
Yeah, you go back to Tom Bradley again. His normal preparation was disrupted this week, counting heavily on Larry Johnson and Ron Vanderlyn, who's up in the press box to help him call the game. But this guy's called enough games over 33 years. He can call a game in his sleep if he needs to. Those guys there are to check him to make sure he's staying on his schedule.
Martinez on third and five, and they set up the screen to Burkhead, and the Nittany Lions are all over it. Astorino, the safety, comes up and makes the initial hit. It's only a 1 yard gain, and another punt coming.
Also, Glenn Carson, number 40, the middle linebacker, does a good job of reading coming out of his zone and splitting defenders on the screen. What I mean by defenders, because I always looked at him as defenders, if you're a big offensive lineman, if you could split two guys will jump to you. But recognition and reaction, Glenn Carson did it well.
Another punt angle toward the sideline and out of bounds.
Goes out of bounds.
And they will mark it at the 13-yard line.
Marked down at the.
Let's take a look at this week's BCS standings, brought to you by Discover Card. Chris and I talked about it a little bit with Stanford behind Alabama, despite the fact the Tide have a loss. Granted, that was against number one LSU. And then you've got the big one on ABC tonight with Stanford taking on Oregon. Clemson leading in its game with Wake Forest right now. Virginia Tech a winner. What a year the Hokies have had. There was some uncertainty about that football team coming into the year, but they're 9-1.
And that's a resilient program with a resilient coach, Frank Beamer. They have to try to get something going here if you're Penn State, just to get the crowd into it and everything else, and also to give their defense a little bit of a break to put together at least a few strings of first downs.
Matt McGloin remains in there at quarterback, and here's Beecham, the backup tailback. And he picks up about 5 to the 18-yard line. Now Nebraska's offense, or Penn State's offense, rather, has struggled. All 5 of their wins have been by 10 points or less. That's the first time that's ever happened in the history of the Big Ten Conference. And they still have games next week at Ohio State, at Wisconsin. Do they have enough offense to win those games and get into the Big Ten Championship?
No, they have enough defense.
Here's Beecham, and he's across the 25 and takes on a defender at the 30. Out to the 32. You know, we were talking about Virginia Tech, Chris. Frank Beamer is now the longest tenured coach in the country, passing Joe Paterno.
Right here, just running away. When you have a 2-shell, that means 2 safeties high, and you have 2 backs in the backfield. There are open gaps. You see Beecham served double duty, by the way, this week. He was also the scout team quarterback for the Penn State defense, and he played Taylor Martinez in practice. I love right there, Dave. You see that? He didn't go out of bounds.
No.
But what did he do? He turned and looked for the contact to lower the shoulder on somebody.
Maybe that'll fire up the rest of the guys on offense. 19 yards on the ground for Beecham as McGloin looks to throw, being chased by Merritt, and throws it out of bounds. Go to the studio and check in with Reese.
All right, Dave, time for a Taco Bell studio update. Oklahoma State is annihilating Texas Tech. Brandon Weeden, Isaiah Anderson, 67th touchdown pass of Weeden's career. That's an Oklahoma State record. 35-0. I think the Pokes might score 100 today.
You know, just for curiosity purposes, wouldn't you like to see them go against an LSU defense or an Alabama defense? I mean, you're talking about an offense that can score any place, anytime, anywhere against a physical, talented defense like LSU and Alabama.
Well, if they went out, they probably will in the championship game. Here's Green straight ahead. We have not seen a lot of Silas Red. Yes, he has 8 carries, but they're really splitting time with Beecham and Stephon Green. Green has 5 carries, Beecham with 2.
A lot of times that's determined by the running back himself. I mean, if he gets in a groove and he gets in a rhythm, then coaches tend to ride the hot hand. And Beecham had a little bit of a hot hand, but he's out.
I did take a look at Red a little bit earlier just to make sure he was okay. Got dinged a little bit as McGloin throws, and it's broken up again. Alfonso Dennard, a senior, who, again, has just had a terrific year, continues to make all Big Ten tight plays.
Break on the football's number one quality of a defensive back, in recognition on a slant, not to break to the man, but break to a spot. That's veteran play, that's smart play, that's NFL corner play.
Meanwhile, another punt. Anthony Farah will kick to Amir Abdullah. They have a total of 252 yards of offense and 3 points between these two schools so far. Fair caught by Abdullah, just shy of the 20-yard line. So it'll be Nebraska ball, 3 timeouts and 3:33 on the first half clock. So far, we have 3 points and 9 punts. And 3:33 on the clock in the second quarter. Nebraska with all of its timeouts, and a pitch to Burkhead on first down. He stumbles across the 25. Picks up 7 to the 27-yard line. Glenn Carson got him for Penn State.
You see a little bit of a hurry up, Mo. Tim Beck's a big repeater of plays. Burkhead had success last series with that play, success on that series.
And a pitch to the other side, and this time Burkhead is stood up by Carson. Minimal gain, so third down and short.
The only difference there, it's run to the right. The 2 times they ran it previous, success was to the left. Always alert, hard count. You got the fans starting to get into it, at least the students are. And now we see the rest of the fans that aren't students rising up a little bit. Where you been?
Quarterback sneak, and Martinez is able to get the first down to the 31-yard line. So far, Martinez with 7 carries. Burkhead has 8, so nothing different for Nebraska in terms of who's touching the football. About a minute off the clock in 3 plays. And Martinez will keep and sandwich to the 32-yard line. Devin Still and Sean Stanley there for Penn State. And either team calling timeout with a 2nd and 9 coming up.
I just sense a different type of player with Taylor Martinez. He's more confident. More confident in his arm. I mean, some of the games we've seen, Dave, where he was almost afraid to throw the football. Today, he's throwing it with confidence and authority, and his decision-making has been outstanding.
And Martinez throwing down the sideline. It's caught in Penn State territory. Kyler Reed at the 45-yard line.
Understanding down and distance, time in the ball game. And I'm speaking to number 8, Lynn. There's nothing there that can help you. Go ahead and help your safety, Suke, out by getting depth with the sideline route and break up on the short routes. That's just knowing where you are in the field and knowing the situation and time in the game.
24-yard pass play. You talked about Martinez's confidence level going up. Here he pitches, and Marlowe didn't have a lot of running room, pushed out by Hodges. You go back to Martinez against Wisconsin. He had 3 interceptions in that game. Nebraska was blown out, and he kind of struggled for two games after that. But maybe it was the win against Michigan State and how they dominated offensively that got him going, because in the last couple of games, he has not made mistakes, and he's made some plays through the air.
And he completed 73% of his passes last week.
Penn State coming after Martinez here. He steps away from pressure and got a man, but the pass was low and incomplete. Oh, Jake Long was open inside the 15-yard line. Martinez underthrew him, though.
Well, the biggest difference here is when he's on target, his feet are set. And what this tells me, he's not a great thrower of the football on the run, because if you can see, he underthrows it. Why? Because when he delivered the football, his feet were parallel. When he gets his feet set and he can step into his target, he's going to throw strikes. When his feet are parallel or on the run, he's not very accurate.
See what he does here on 3rd and 6 at the Penn State 40-yard line. Steps up and finds an unwall, and it's a Nebraska first down. Clock will stop as they reset the ball, and Nebraska still has all of its timeouts.
Maturity right there. You thought Taylor Martinez last year would take and try to get the first down by his feet, kept his eyes downfield, and delivered the first down to an open receiver.
Another pass play, and Martinez finds Kyrie Cooper. And he's out of bounds inside the 20-yard line. It's only the 4th catch of the year for Kyrie Cooper. What a big play, and Nebraska's in the Penn State red zone. First down at the 15. 1:13 on the clock and 3 timeouts left. Play action. Martinez to the air again. Gets away from Crawford. Martinez somehow got away from 2 defenders, then grabbed to the ankles by Nate Stupar and brought down after a 1-yard gain. And Nebraska will call a timeout. So 2 left and 61 seconds remaining in the half. Right now we check in with Reese Davis in the studio. Well, Reese is going to talk about what he's seen along with Mark. What about you, Chris? What have you seen so far today?
Well, I've seen, a typical Penn State game. I haven't noticed anything where they've been disrupted at all in how they're playing. I think the coaching has been good. Offensively, they're struggling, which we kind of see Penn State's offense do. Defensively, they've been pretty strong. But I like what I've seen out of Nebraska so far. They've kind of answered this challenge. They're sticking what they do. The triple option game has been a little bit of a problem for Penn State. And Taylor Martinez has thrown the ball very well.
100 yards passing, 9 of 17. 2nd and 9 at the 14 of Penn State. Here's Burkhead, who looks like he might throw. And he does to the end zone, but out of play. A halfback pass. It's incomplete, so the clock stopped. 55 seconds left. Now Bell might have been the intended receiver. And it's third down.
Boy, that was a setup from three plays ago where we saw the toss sweep to the right. Remember that? Hoping to get Penn State to bite. But again, we saw discipline by Paul Bellini's defense. You see discipline right there and understand this situation by Tom Bradley and the Nittany Lion D.
Penn State has allowed only 12 touchdowns on the year. That's third fewest in the country. Will they surrender one here? Third and 10 of the play clock is at one. Martinez has to hurry. That should be delay, and it is. Flag comes down. It'll be third and 14.
Timeout, Nebraska.
Oh, Nebraska able to get
the
a timeout.
Second charge, timeout.
Boy, the flag came in at the same time as Bo Pelini ran over to the official and called a timeout. We talked with Pelini and the Nebraska coaches on Wednesday about how they would handle the week, and they said, look, we recognize what's going on there, and we are praying for the victims in these allegations, but we also have a job to do trying to get our kids prepared and avoid the distractions. And it would seem, at least early on, that they've done a good job of that in terms of their game plan and how they've executed.
Well, I think they've been outstanding, and right here on this play, they're going to get a two-deep look by Penn State, where a lot of times the middle of the field is open. But I want to say this. I think to show respect for Penn State, you know the best thing you do? You come out here and play the game of football as hard and as tough as you can. That's what it's supposed to be, and that's what they've done so far today.
And we'll see what they can come up with here on third down and 10. So no penalty, timeout, one remaining. And Martinez in trouble, fires, and it is incomplete, but a flag comes down. Marlowe, the intended receiver, was hit by Nick Suke, and it'll be a defensive penalty and a first down for Penn State, or for Nebraska, rather.
Well, we talked about the middle of the field to be open, and Taylor Martinez was allowing Marlowe to come in, and again, the patience of Taylor Martinez to let the route develop and throw to the window. That's not to the man.
Defense, number one. Ball is placed at the spot of a foul. The 2-yard line, automatic first down.
But to the area. You see Suke come over and clearly arrived before the ball. And Suke has to find a way to come around.
So first and goal from the 2. As Burkhead is lined up under center. And it's a pitch to Abdullah, pushing to the goal line. And touchdown. Rushing touchdown for Abdullah, the true freshman. You see Burkhead trying to help out, blocking a couple of Penn State defenders, and Nebraska leads it 9-0.
Well, you have to have a lot of confidence in Burkhead to have him take snaps from under center in a crucial situation. No problem with the ball exchange, good pitch, and he turns into the lead blocker to lead Abdullah.
The point after makes a 10-zip, a 12-play, 80-yard drive, and that's a big score given not just what we've seen today from Penn State's offense, but the way the Nittany Lion offense has played all year. Now, they do have 2 timeouts and 44 seconds to work with, and we'll see how they approach it. Down 10-0 in this ball game. They did get inside the 40-yard line one try, but missed on a field goal. As you look at Tom Bradley, you know, like so many of these coaches have been around for a long time here in State College, 33rd year on the staff, 12th as defensive coordinator. He replaced Jerry Sandusky. He was a player here. His brothers played at Penn State, and he has wanted an opportunity at some point when Joe Paterno retired to be the head coach. As he told us yesterday, under these circumstances, he never thought it would come to this. And he's trying to handle it the best he can, considering at 9:59 Eastern Wednesday, he was the defensive coordinator. And at 10 o'clock, when the Board of Trustees made their announcement, he was now the interim head coach.
And obviously mixed emotions, but he also understands the responsibility that he has to his university and to this football team.
Here is Powell for Penn State. Looking for a seam. It's not there. Bottled up short of the 20 at the 19. Lance Thorell down there along with Will Richards for Nebraska.
Again, this is not much of a choice, but we'll see what Coach Bradley decides to do. And Jay Paterno, 39 seconds, probably best to go ahead and be safe, run the football, run the clock out, go in and make your halftime adjustments. I'm telling you one thing, if Nebraska's pass defense is on, there's nobody in the country that covers as a unit like that secondary. Nobody.
No, they come in 20th in the country in pass defense.
I'm just going by my eyes.
Yep. First down for Penn State on its 19, and they will hand it off here to Beecham. And able to get around the end. And boy, if he broke that last tackle, he had a big gain, as it is. It picks up 12. The clock will stop as they reset the chains. We'll see if Penn State uses a timeout. Two remaining. They're going to go hurry up and put McGloin in shotgun formation.
Let's see. They might be trying to get something going, Dave.
Well, after that first down play, why not? If you got nothing on first down, you could see why they'd be conservative. McGloin with a dangerous throw. Caught Moy, and it's another first down. Clock stops again with 22 seconds remaining. Ball at the Penn State 42, and they save their timeout.
So you figure they got to get down to probably around the 23-yard line where Farrah has a long of 40 yards on the year.
And he missed a field goal earlier in this game of 47 yards.
And be disciplined if you're Nebraska's defense. Keep everything in front, nothing overhead.
McGloin stepping up. Now roaming to his right, takes off, there's a flag. And it's a good pickup as McGloin is into Nebraska territory, but it's likely coming back.
Personal foul.
Personal foul. Going to be an offensive face mask call. You don't see that very often. Deontay Pinnell, the right guard, was getting into
personal
it.
Personal foul, face mask, offense, number 50. 15-yard penalty, replay first down.
So that might end any thought of trying to get points here with only 13 seconds left and backed up inside your 30 again.
Sometimes with offensive linemen, they get their hands inside and then hands and arms and things are punching and you're trying to get position, the hand will slip up into the face. But they called it a personal foul, so I don't know if he actually grabbed it and yanked it, which would certainly be cause for the flag and the 15.
Now the clock running with 3 seconds left. See if Penn State gets off one more play. Nope. They won't. That's the end of the half. Well, Penn State outgained Nebraska, but it's the Cornhuskers leading 10 to nothing. Here's Lisa Salter.
Coach, Taylor Martinez looks like he's really getting into a rhythm right now. What's working for him?
You know, I think we've done a pretty good job of keeping him off balance, got a good mix of run and pass, and he's executing well. He's confident and he's been playing well. He's just got to, we got 30 more minutes to go.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Dave.
And so far in this game, Burkhead and Martinez splitting carries. Meanwhile, Penn State, no points, a missed field goal, and Tom Bradley, the interim head coach, is standing by with Tom Rinaldi.
Thanks, Dave. Coach, how would you say your team handled all the emotions surrounding the start of this game?
Got off to a good start in the first quarter. We just got to sustain some drives and do a little better job tackling on defense. And for us, it's just get back to some good fundamentals.
Shutout on the scoreboard through the first half. Tom, what's the key transition you need to make to build some momentum?
We need to get a big play here, get a drive going. I think that'll turn the tide a little bit for us.
Thanks very much, Tom. Appreciate it. Dave?
Tommy did it in 06 when Joe Paterno wasn't here because of injury, but this will be a different halftime speech for Tom Bradley with his team down 10-0 to Nebraska. Now let's go to Reese Davis in the studio. It's the Bud Light halftime report. With Chris Spielman here at Beaver Stadium. Chris, we got here on Thursday and met with coaches and players and got to the stadium at 8 this morning. Is this what you expected, not just the atmosphere, but what we've seen on the field?
Yeah, I think it's kind of that. Coaches are emotional, but they're all focused in on the game right now. They've really responded well as far as the on-field operation and how the players play. I mean, Penn State's playing like Penn State.
Yeah, I remember Joe Paterno has said in the past, this is what we are. We're not going to beat teams 48-0. And the other coaches were telling us on Friday that the players have embraced that, and that's a big reason why they're 5-0. Winning close games is okay, and they're in a close one again, at least right now. But Nebraska will get the ball fresh off a 12-play, 80-yard scoring drive to take a 10-0 lead. Here's Kenny Bell on the return for the Huskers, and he gets drilled at the 22-yard line. What a stick. Stephon Green.
The one thing as a returner, you see some of the biggest hits by the kickoff team. He gets high load right here, and Green's going to come in and do a good job of hitting what he sees, seeing what he hits, head up, shoulder through, and bringing his feet and almost creating a turnover. And I think right now for Penn State to get a little action, to get people into the game, not only on the sidelines, but also in the stands, as their defense could create something, either field position or turnover.
Burkhead on first down, big hole right down the middle. Near the first down marker at the 33-yard line. Drew Astorino, the safety, made the stop.
Burkhead was questioned last week. Did he hit the wall? And right now, he's running with a little passion and a little bit of a purpose. You see Choi pulling around there. And when an offensive guard can pull around, Dave, and he gets to the second level, pretty good chance that the running back is getting to the second level.
Meanwhile, Chris, an injury. Wide receiver Kyrie Cooper shaking up on the play. I mentioned Nebraska is light on the defensive line because of injuries. They're light on their offensive line as well. And now a wide receiver who did make a big catch in the first half, Kyrie Cooper. Cooper is down.
And one thing Nebraska's offense has done throughout the first half, and Bo Pelini talked about it going off the field, is that they have good balance going. And when you have Taylor Martinez throwing the ball, or at least being the threat that he is throwing the ball, that puts a lot of pressure on the defense. And it might alter the calls that Tom Bradley makes.
South Carolina 14, Florida 3.
Rolled up on by Burkhead that time after that 10-yard gain. So it is a first down for Nebraska. So far, Burkhead, 9 carries, 49 yards. So he's right at 1,000 for the season. They go with their diamond package that they like so much, and Martinez throws, but it's wild, intended for Kenny Bell, second and 10.
I don't know if that's wild. And the only reason I say that, Kenny Bell, I don't think, read the corner. The corner was off, so you have a hitch. Kenny Bell ran the route too far. Just again, a difference if you're going to throw the football. The difference is the recognition and the success determined by the recognition by the receiver and the quarterback.
They fake the inside run now. A pitch, and Burkhead picks it up on one hop and breaks a tackle, but they're going to say that it was a forward pass, a shovel pass, so it's incomplete.
Triple option again.
That looks like a lateral. Now it was recovered by Nebraska, so even if it's overturned, you'd have a loss on the play because you negate the run after. You would count the recovery. Let's see if they review this, because it would cost Nebraska a couple of yards. Doesn't look like they're going to. Flag down. It's a dead ball foul. There was contact on the offensive line made by a defensive lineman. Was that defensive lineman forced to jump?
Prior to the snap. False start. Offense. Number 41. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
So it'll be third down and 15. Now they have converted some third and longs today with the arm of Martinez.
I see the enthusiasm of Tom Bradley on the sidelines. Dialed up a blitz. Let's see if he gambles a little bit and comes with pressure, plays it safe. A drop in 7.
Martinez throws, and nowhere to go for Bell. He had Nate Stupar all over him, and he got only a couple yards. And Penn State's defense forces a Nebraska punt.
Not only did they force a punt, but maybe they forced this crowd to get into it. to create some energy. And I think it was good for Penn State to be down 10-0 to start on defense to hopefully set the tempo for their offense, in which they should have done with the three and out.
Again, two men deep for Penn State. Brown and Astorino. And this one again sails out of bounds, and it'll be marked at the 30-yard line. Well, Matt McGloin starting for the third straight game, and really the first move in terms of personnel made by interim head coach Tom Bradley was telling us, McGloin's my guy, and it's going to be my decision whether to pull him or not. In previous games, either Rob Bolden started or would rotate with McGloin. But Bolden has not played yet in this game.
I promise you this, one difference we're seeing today, if Joe Paterno were on the sidelines, Bolden would have played by now.
And Nebraska late getting a defender on the field. They had 10 men there. First down, Penn State on the 30. Silas Red was shaken up earlier in the game, but he's out there now and trying to find a hole. Not a lot of running room for the Penn State backs. Gain of 3 or 4. Thorell, the guy who was late running out of the field, was the one who made the tackle.
And one of the questions you might be asking, why doesn't Penn State throw some short passes just to get McGloin into rhythm? The reason is, Dave, Nebraska plays a hard cover two look. When I say hard, I mean their corners are up there in your face and challenge you all day. And with their linebackers, they jump underneath routes, so it's tough to run short passes.
You can do that with a cover corner like Dennard, who's already made a couple plays today. McGloin in the pocket, unloads, and it's pulled in for a first down by Andrew Zerba, the tight end. 13 yards and a Nittany Lion first down.
All set up by Davon Smith, a speeder running underneath. You're going to see number 20 Smith come in. He draws Levante David up to him. When you draw him up, you know you have one behind. The rule is in zone defense, one in front, one behind.
And quickly to the line of scrimmage, Silas Red into Nebraska territory where Cassidy greets him. Good pickup on the ground there of about 6 yards.
Like what Penn State's doing, no huddle, to get a little rhythm and get a little tempo and really dictate to Nebraska what they should do defensively.
10th carry of the day for Red. Here comes number 11. And he is hit by Will Compton and pushed back short of the first down by about a yard. So third down coming up. What do you expect here? Do you give it to Red again, or do you have some sort of play action?
Well, I'm partial to the quarterback sneak into a gap, empty area in the offensive line.
It is a run play to the handoff. Stephon Green is in there for Red, and he's got the first down, dragged down by Levante David. The last time Penn State got down here, they had to attempt a 47-yard field goal and missed.
Again, a good changeup by Galen Hall. Jake Paterno coming with the no huddle to get a little bit of tempo, get a rhythm going for McGloin.
And McGloin with the straight drop. In trouble and sacked at the 47-yard line. Cameron Meredith was there. The ball came out and Nebraska recovers. Eric Martin with a fumble recovery as McGloin got hit and lost the ball.
Recovered by number 46. Eric Martin.
Nebraska will create coverage sacks. Great coverage downfield. You see Meredith come in. That ball was loose. The whistle did not blow. You see the umpire right on his spot with the beanbag of the marking of the ball. Coverage sack. I mean, the protection was there. That's where McGloin has to make the decision to throw it away.
So a good drive by Penn State. Negated by a turnover, putting Nebraska at midfield. And Martinez wrapped up, maybe lost a yard as Nate Stupar is there along with Eric Lattimore.
That's might where we see the counter to that option that gave Penn State a little bit of trouble to Tom Bradley. On Thursday, they worked in practice on bringing pressure or blitz looks from the field, the strong side of the wide side of the field. It's a good call and a good counter.
They send Martinez wide to the right, put Burkhead in shotgun as the Wildcat quarterback. And here's Burkhead with running room. And Burkhead has a first down to the 40-yard line. Danton Lynn on the tackle.
Watch Spencer Long, number 61. He's going to take you to the play. It's just a read option. And again, I keep going to the point. When you have pulling guards getting to the second level untouched, that means that Penn State is out of whack gap-wise.
Here's Burkhead this time with a pitch from Martinez, somehow able to squirt through a hole and picks up about 8 yards to the 33-yard line.
He's running with a little anger today, isn't he? I mean, he was called out last week a little bit about hitting the wall. Maybe we should take him out, give other guys a chance. I'll tell you, a player here is that. He's going to find a new gear.
He averaged 3 yards a carry last week. He's at 6 yards a carry today. Burkhead on second and two. And Burkhead.
Burkhead, the ball
right
carrier.
At the first down marker, Glenn Carson, the middle linebacker on the tackle. It appears to be just short, so third down.
Third down and one for Nebraska.
Same question, other side. Same. Give it to the running back again or play action?
My same answer, which it will be forever, is quarterback sneak to get the first right in this empty gap right there.
Martinez with play action and on the bootleg. He's hit, but he's able to get the first down. He lost the ball. It was recovered by Nebraska anyway. We'll see if they ruled that Martinez was down. It was Stupar and Lattimore on the tackle.
It's worth the risk to get Taylor Martinez out on the edge to give him the run pass option.
Well, I think he's down and it's a first down. The ball came out after he hit the ground and it looked like the ball had already crossed and should be a Nebraska first down.
That's why I say, you ask him play action. It's worth the risk when you have a guy that can use his feet like Taylor Martinez.
No measure here. But it's a first down for Nebraska. Now we saw that Michigan State was dominating Iowa at halftime, so it becomes for Bo Pelini and company imperative that they win this game. They can't fall two games behind Michigan State, even though they've beaten them head-to-head in the Legends Division. Nebraska still next week plays on the road at Michigan, then home to Iowa. And meanwhile, Penn State unbeaten at 5-0, but tough games left in the Leaders Division against Ohio State and Wisconsin as Burkhead takes the direct snap. Drops to throw, and instead he runs toward the sideline and out of play. Astorino knocked him out. Burkhead threw a pass in the first half on a halfback toss, and this time he's in the pocket looking to throw.
I'm only laughing a little bit because Tim Beck is just drawing him up in the dirt. It's like a mad scientist back in the meeting room in Lincoln. He and Bo Pelini, I mean, that's dangerous to have a running back go to a drop back situation.
Is in the backfield now, and Martinez keeps big hole down the middle. He's inside the 15. First down, Nebraska.
Boy, it's all about reading the defensive end. Watch Taylor Martinez. Watch his eyes. They're going to look at the defensive lineman. He sees the defensive lineman go with Hurd, and he has patience and enough burst and speed to get through there. But it's execution of the spread option at its finest right there, and a great read by Taylor Martinez. Reading the defensive end going out, burst right through the middle.
17-yard run. Remember, this drive started at midfield after a Penn State turnover. Martinez keeping and then pitching at the last second. And Burkhead is in. Touchdown, Nebraska.
Touchdown, Nebraska.
Martinez was wrapped up and going down. Yet he pitched to Burkhead, who takes it in from 14 yards out.
Well, this is a speed option with the lead blocker. Here's the speed option. No fake, just right down the line. Brigade's going to come out and get his block. And Martinez, trusting Burkhead will be at the right relationship between quarterback and pitch, throws the ball into space. Burkhead gets it on the run and knows how to finish.
And they might take a look at this to see if Martinez was down before the pitch. They're going to review this further to see if Martinez was down before he pitched it to Burkhead. That was Burkhead's 14th rushing touchdown. But will it come back? Let's see here. He's grabbed by Drew Astorino. And boy, from that angle, hard to tell whether the knee is down. Let's see here. Looks like the left knee might be down. Hard to see in that shadow, though, if the left knee was down. Looked like the right knee was still up.
Well, that, and seeing if it's a forwarded pitch. That's, we understand that's what the replay booth is looking at, to see if it was a forward pitch. And to me, that was certainly legal from that angle.
Yeah, so you got to look at, was his knee down? Was he across the line of scrimmage? It's got to be the whole body across the line of scrimmage for it to be a penalty. And was it a forward pass or a backwards pass?
I think that's absolutely legal, and that's a trust. And Burkhead catches the ball in stride. And again, once he gets to the end zone area, he knows how to finish.
The ruling on the field of a touchdown is confirmed.
So it's confirmed. That means they had, with the video help there, enough to rule that it's a touchdown. So not only was his knee not down, but it was a backwards lateral. Earlier, they called a forward pass on what looked like a backward lateral. Maher on for the point after. And Nebraska has opened up a 17-0 lead. An 8-play drive after the Penn State turnover. All run plays right at the number 8 defense in the nation. And they are in command in State College. In Nebraska. After the turnover by Penn State, Rex Burkhead went to work, lining up several different places on the field. Here's Taylor Martinez. Right down the middle for a long run then. At the last second before going down, a pitch to Burkhead, and he takes it in for his 14th rushing touchdown of the season. 8-play, 52-yard drive. It is 17-0 Nebraska.
Remember in our meetings yesterday with Larry Johnson, Coach Vanderlinden, we talked about what could give you trouble, what made you nervous. And I said, does the option make you nervous? And I said, absolutely, especially not so much a spread option look, but the option that they had on the touchdown to Burkhead, the old traditional option, speed option, belly option, quarterback down the line, reading and pitching.
Maher kicking away to Powell and Amos. It'll be Chaz Powell. He had trouble with the football. And in trouble back at his 15-yard line. Able to push forward to the 18 as we go to Reese Davis in the studio.
All right, Dave, time for an innovative look at the Stanford offense brought to you by AT&T. Cardinal have been very good using three tight ends this year, and Andrew Luck has one of those guys, Zach Ertz, who's been hurt and doubtful right now. But this guy will have on the field, number 82, Colby Fleener. Fleener's got the big speed from the tight end position. We'll see if they can utilize that against Oregon tonight.
Chris, Andrew Luck, the best quarterback since whom?
I think he's an athletic Peyton Manning.
McGloin's thrown, caught in the middle of the field by Justin Brown for a gain of about 9. So does that mean he's better?
Since whom? Peyton Manning. Is he better? I can't answer that question until he plays 10 years. Then I'll answer it. I got news for you. There's not too many better than Aaron Rodgers right now.
Yep.
Because he is a robot. He's a machine. It's unbelievable what he's doing.
They have perfected that back shoulder fade. Second and one. Here's Silas Redd looking for a hole. Finds it. Gets the first down. Joe Carter made the tackle. How does Penn State come back in this game? Because they're not a high-octane offense anyway.
You have enough time, and I just think you have to up the tempo. You're not going to go your no-huddle offense quite yet, so you up the tempo when the ball is snapped. And again, you've got to try to take some shots down the field and get McGloin involved. But Nebraska is so good with their matchup zone. They take away underneath routes.
Silas Redd trying to be patient, but there's just no hole. Dropped by Levante David after a gain of 1. They've been inside the 40 of Nebraska twice. In the first half, they got to the 30 and missed a field goal. And then last time they had the ball, they got to the 40 before McGloin was sacked, lost the ball. Nebraska recovered and then turned it into 7 points.
One thing you might want to think about if you're Penn State is getting number 6, Derek Moy, involved into your offense.
Here's play action for McGloin. He'll go to the sideline and a diving attempt and the catch made at the 41 by Davon Smith. 10 yards and it's a first down. Got the foot down and let's see if he's able to keep possession to the ground. Looks like he did. Ball may have hit the ground there. It was close. First down from the 41 for Penn State. Inside run to Green. And he takes out a defender and loses that battle. Austin Cassidy with the lick at the 45. It's a 4-yard gain.
So Andrew Green, number 11, who's been solid all day, is now coming out of the ball game. John Baptiste, number 16, just comes in the corner. If they have eyes in the sky, what you do is you go attack him and attack him now. Number 16 just came into the game. You've got Derek Moy on him right there. If you have a play, he's matched up. Go deep, go now.
He was a wide receiver earlier in the season, now playing corner. And the pass is caught at midfield, thrown the other way where Dennard was. It's caught by Justin Brown, just short of the first down.
Now he's still out there, and he's still not warmed up. And a lot of times, he's not playing a lot because he's still learning the position, and he's learning the concept of zone and matchup and all that good stuff. So again, somebody on Penn State, at least go attack him. Now he's protected unless they come with a play action with a tight end on a 7 route.
Well, they're just going to quarterback sneak it here, but wait, there's flags down. That was 3rd and 1.
And you see right there, Jean Baptiste did not know where to line up.
Legal substitution. Defense. 12 players in the formation. 5-yard penalty results in a first down.
I think in that situation, Jean Baptiste was supposed to be out of the game. He was the 12th man, so it's a first down for Penn State.
You see number 11, Green, back into the ball game, who took a little shot on the last tackle they made.
So first down at the 45. See if Penn State can capitalize getting into Nebraska territory. If nothing else, pin the Huskers deep with a punt. They need points soon. McGloin with time and going to go deep for Moy. He makes the catch. First down and goal at the 5 for Penn State.
Adjustments to the football. Green loses sight of where he is. You see Moy kept his eyes on the ball, steps in front of the defensive back. And again, Dave, I can't overemphasize it. 6'5", what an advantage it is for that wide receiver. Good coverage, just Moy makes a more athletic play at 6'5".
40 yards, first and goal. And they've got Moy lined up in the backfield behind Zordich, the fullback. Now they'll motion Moy to the left of the formation. And that's where McGloin's going. Jump ball. And it is. Incomplete, defended by Justin Blatchford. A player doesn't get a lot of time on defense. Who is defending Moy. Might have been holding his jersey as well.
It's a nice matchup you want to have. Again, they're trying to throw the inside-out fade.
Shouldn't that have been interference, Chris?
Yeah, I think it should have been at least a holding call. Looks like he had a little bit of jersey inside there.
Second and goal at the 5. Stephon Green now at the backfield. Here's Green. He's in! Touchdown, Penn State! Stephon Green had 10 attempts all year. Prior to today, he's got 8 in this game. And his second touchdown of the season hits Penn State on the board at the 5:07 mark. They're within 10, 17-7.
What an answer. Stephon Green, I'm a senior. I'm going to do all I can. How about getting 6?
First meeting in 8 years for Nebraska Penn State in the new Big Ten. They are crossover divisional rivals, so they'll play every year now as Penn State finally on the board. 9-play, 82-yard drive engineered by McGloin. It was 4-5 passing for 64 yards. And the big play, a Derek Moy catch for 40 yards. Abdullah deep along with Marlowe. And Marlowe's got it for Nebraska. Through a hole! And boy, that tackle wasn't made by Penn State. Marlowe's still running. Penn State back in it, though. Down 10 at the 5-minute mark of the third. Well, it took 2.5 quarters, but Penn State finally on the board, though still trailing Nebraska by 10. Got a Big Ten matchup here. The SEC takes center stage tonight with three games on the ESPN networks, 7:45 on ESPN. Alabama looks to rebound after losing to LSU last week, taking on Mississippi State. Nebraska first and 10 on its 33-yard line, and they put Burkhead under center, the tailback. And he gets hit immediately and spilled by Devin Still, who makes another play in the backfield. Now there is a penalty flag down.
And Nebraska jumped in a different cadence by Burkhead. Might have drew the Cornhusker offensive line off. Got him going a little early.
Before the snap, false start. Offense, number 61, 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
That's on the right guard, Spencer Long. So first and 15 now. And the crowd's starting to come alive here at Beaver Stadium. They've been quiet for most of this game. Martinez O'Keefe, he runs into an offensive lineman and gets maybe 3 or 4. Glenn Carson was in there for Penn State, so second and long.
Just want to make a point that you made. I, to my right in the student section, they're going crazy. They're helping the Nittany Lion defense. If Penn State needs an extra ally, another teammate to step up, it's the other 100,000 people in this building to make noise, to make it difficult for Nebraska. That's what you would like to see if you're a Penn State fan. They're not doing it.
Second and long for Nebraska. So in the score tower there, Oklahoma State still putting it on Texas Tech as Martinez goes downfield, and Kenny Bell is inside the 45 of Penn State. Martinez continues to make big plays with his arm. This time his wide receiver held on.
Here's he makes this play with his eyes. Watch his head. He's going to look to his left. See that little look to the left? That drew the safety, Suke, over to the left. And Martinez just comes right back, understanding where the route's being thrown, and throwing to a window.
Martinez keeping, trying to get outside. And Astorino trying to rip the ball away, and they do for a moment, but then they rule Martinez down. It came out for a second, and then Martinez grabbed the hold of it again, and they spot him at the 38, so it's a gain of 4 or 5. Now Kenny Bell, the wide receiver who caught that first down pass earlier, is shaken up for Nebraska.
What do we know about Nebraska's offense and when they want to snap the ball, Dave?
Quickly.
Now, why? I mean, you're playing an offense in Penn State that takes a long time to methodically move the ball down the field. Mm-hmm. So if I'm Nebraska, right now I start thinking about, all right, let me run that play clock down before I snap the football to 2 or 3 seconds.
But what if that's not what you do? What if that's not what you're comfortable with as an offense?
I think your game plan is good enough today that it doesn't matter if you snap it at 15 or at 3. But what it does do is take away seconds off the clock to give the ball to an offense that isn't a quick strike offense. That would be the wise thing to do.
Martinez stepping up and grabbed by Still and brought down. No gain. So third down and 5. We've seen, with the exception of that pass downfield, mostly run plays here in the third quarter. What do you think?
Well, I think you take your shots down the field because you've had open receivers down the field, especially in the middle of the field. The linebackers from Penn State are jumping the underneath routes. They're not getting depth. That's why you had Kenny Bell open at 14 yards on a crossing route.
Might be at a field goal range here. Maher does have a big leg, though. It'd be about a 55-yard attempt. Third and 4. Martinez, and it is bobbled and incomplete. Kenny had a shot at it. He dropped one earlier. The defender may have had an impact on that, but Kenny was upset with himself. Let's see.
Well, what happens is Kenny lets the ball get to the breastplate, which bounces off, goes right through his hands. Instead of going out with his hands and catching it, be a leader, Taylor. You made a good throw. Go congratulate him. Say pat him on the back. and say, you'll get it next time, I'm coming back to you.
Now Mara's attempted 5 kicks over 50 yards. This would be about a 55 yarder, but they elect to punt. See if Mara can pin Penn State deep.
That's the right decision against this type of offense.
Maybe try to draw Penn State offside, and that's why they took the play clock down there, because if there were an offside penalty, it would have been a first down for Nebraska.
Offense, number 96, 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
And the other reason they do that is give the punter a little bit more room to drop it inside, especially with a guy with a big leg.
Justin Brown is the deep man. Inside 3 to play here in the third quarter. Penn State, the only unbeaten team left in conference play in the Big Ten. Only loss on the year was home against Alabama. Brown with the fair catch signal. He had some room in front of him, but he elected to fair catch at the 14-yard line. Here's Reese in the studio.
Dave, Clemson trying to wrap up the ACC Atlantic. Wake Forest still alive and up 21-14. In fact, they scored 3 touchdowns in a little over 4 minutes. Brandon Pendergrass over 100 yards rushing. Clemson's just answered. Wild one going on at Clemson. 28-21, Demon Deacons.
Wow. Well, it's been a terrific year for Wake Forest. We've seen Clemson at home a couple times. They're so hard to beat there, especially with all the talent and speed they have. Meanwhile, Penn State with the ball, down 10. Inside its 15-yard line. Beecham is the tailback. McGloin has started and played every snap at quarterback. Beecham can't find a hole. Grounded at the 16. Gain of a couple. Terrence Moore there for the Huskers. And McGloin on the day, 12 of 23 for 166 yards.
If you're Penn State again, you want to get a little bit of a sense of urgency going here. I'm not saying too much. Make sure you communicate the play. But right now, they're a little lackadaisical. Let's see where the ball snapped right now at 19 and counting on the play clock.
They have a missed field goal and a fumble by McGloin at midfield that led to a Nebraska touchdown. Short setup here for McGloin. There was contact downfield. I don't know, that's not a penalty. There was holding there. Moy was grabbed by Andrew Green. Now the pass was way over Moy's head.
Talked to Corey Raymond, the secondary coach, and raved about Andrew Green, how well he's played the past few weeks. When you have a corner on top of you like that, you talked about it with Aaron Rodgers and the Green Bay Packers. You throw the back shoulder fade. And that's where these guys are still not on the same page. That could be because Moy's been absent or not at full speed for a few weeks.
Here's McGloin on 3rd down and 8. Need the quarterback to make a play. He's going to air it out into double coverage, and it's nowhere near the intended receiver, Davon Smith. So a 3 and out for Penn State, and they'll have to punt from inside their 20-yard line.
Let's see Jay Paterno. He and Galen Hall share play calling duties.
And Jay normally upstairs, but with Mike McQuarrie placed on administrative leave, Jay is now downstairs playing the role of sending in the signals. That is what McQuarrie did on game day for this Penn State staff.
Tom Bradley holds Jay Paterno in high regard, and so do I. I think he's a fine football coach.
Abdullah the deep man. Farah gets off a good punt, and Abdullah backs up to his 32 for the fair catch, and now a flag. As there was some contact, the Nebraska player ran over Nick Suke. After the play, it was a 54-yard punt, by the way. This could be a 15-yard penalty as well. It was after the play.
And what it could create is a chance, only a chance, for Penn State's defense to give their offense some type of field position if they're able to hold.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Receiving team, number 15. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
So that's on Dennard. And boy, thanks to that punt by Farah and the 15-yard penalty, it's a net of 69 yards. And now Nebraska's backed up to its 17-yard line. Let's see here. It wasn't Dennard. It was number 5 for Nebraska, Braylon Hurd. So first down for the Huskers on their 17-yard line. Martinez will keep and going nowhere. Dumped by Crawford. A gain of a yard. Second and nine coming up. We're inside 2 minutes to go in the third.
And for the first time, Dave, I noticed the fans that are directly below us, at least on the first level, are standing up and making noise to try to help this Nittany Lion defense out.
It's Burkhead between the tackles, and again, he finds running room to the 25. Penn State has maybe the best tandem of defensive tackles in the Big Ten in Jordan Hill and Devin Still, but why the running lanes between the tackles for Burkhead?
Because the pulling guards are getting to the second level. They're not getting any penetration inside, and they're getting on linebackers that are supposed to fill those holes. That time, again, number 61. Spencer Long with a lead block getting to the linebacker level.
Third down and short. Martinez will throw. It's caught by Anunua. And it's a Nebraska first down to the 32-yard line. Danton Lynn and Suke team up on the stop.
It's a confident throw. Again, it's a little bit of a fadeaway. But he's on target with some zip. I don't care how he gets it there. If he throws it that hard and that on target, he can throw it off his head.
To the ground in Burkhead. And spun down at the 35 after a gain of four. Stupar on the tackle. My Nebraska done a terrific job running the football today. 150 yards against Penn State's defense. And Burkhead leading the way with 93. He's over 1,000 yards for the season. It's a guy that was looked at by Texas A&M and Stanford and Nebraska. That was about it. And the junior from Plano, Texas, has turned into a pretty good Big Ten player. He's helping his team lead by 10 after three, trying to get a road win in State College.
Brazil's World Soccer Tour continues as they bring their beautiful game to Qatar. Watch as the five-time world champions take on the Pharaohs at the Al Rayyan Stadium. Don't miss Brazil, Egypt, this Tuesday, live on ESPN. There is a place where Christmas trees light up all year.
Temperature in the mid-50s here in State College as we bring you our game track brought to you by Bud Light. Nebraska on top, 17-7. Penn State has not lost a game in Big Ten play. Meanwhile, Martinez has been effective throwing and running. Burkhead has been the star, though, for Nebraska. 16 carries, 93 yards, and a touchdown. Nebraska has not defeated a team on the road ranked higher than 17th since 1997. Number two, Washington, as Burkhead on second down. Powers to the 38 for three. It'll bring up third and three. Nate Stupar on the tackle.
And two things Nebraska likes to do in this type of situation. They like a little quick outside hitch routes, or they go to their option game with Taylor Martinez and Burkhead. Look at the depth of Burkhead. That's an alert run to me. He's about 7 yards back.
Now Martinez backs off, looks to the sideline for the check. Still plenty of time on the play clock at 10. Martinez to throw on third down. Broken up and almost picked off. Anunua, the intended receiver. Danton Lynn had coverage. It's fourth down and Nebraska has to kick it away.
Boy, the one thing you'd like to see, Martinez, is this where you want to throw it low? That way the defensive back only has one way to get to the ball. He doesn't have the chance to vertical. If you throw it low, then the defensive back, Lynn, would have to come over top and interfere.
Astorino and Brown are deep for the Maher punt. It'll be a seventh punt of the day. Four, though, previous six have landed inside the 20. Penn State got close in the first half. The blocking one, that one was close as well as Brown takes off across the 30-yard line and out to the 35. So solid starting field position for Penn State. Three of the top four teams in action tonight on the ESPN networks on ABC at 8 Eastern. A terrific game of the Pac-12 as Stanford welcomes Oregon. LaMichael James
Andrew Luck will be on display.
I'm feeling that upset, David.
You are, really?
I really am. I don't know why. I mean, it's tough to bet against a guy like Andrew Luck, but Oregon's so explosive offensively.
It's not just Andrew Luck. Stanford, all around, pretty good football team. Here's McGloin on first and 10. And a short throw, and a broken tackle. And out across the 35 is Stephon Green for a gain of about 3. Here's Reese.
Dave, time for a SportsCenter right now, presented by Discover Card. Washington Nationals catcher Wilson Ramos has been reunited with his family and brings to an end a 2-day ordeal in which he was kidnapped in his native Venezuela. Police commandos swooped in to rescue him in a flurry of gunfire late last night and arrested the 4 alleged abductors.
All right, there's great news there. Meanwhile, Penn State on 2nd and 7, running Green, and he is taken down after he got the first down at the 45. It's the best starting field position for Penn State today. Let's see if the Nittany Lions can capitalize. Down 10 early in the fourth. Jay Paterno and what could be his final game. With his father no longer the head coach, what does the future hold for him and for the entire staff, including interim coach Tom Bradley? Penn State's final 2 regular season games on the road at Ohio State and Wisconsin. There's McGloin off play action, going downfield, and it's incomplete. There's some contact along the sideline on the pass intended for Brown, but no flag.
Boy, they're trying to hook up deep to Derek Moy. Nebraska understands the situation in the game. Cassidy, the safety, did nothing to bite up on the underneath route. Got his depth to help his partner Green out on corner to take away Moy on a deep crosser.
At the 46-yard line.
Stephon Green getting a lot of reps. Silas Redd with 13 carries. He also got banged up in the first half. Green again. And not much running room. Austin Cassidy made the tackle after a gain of about 2 or 3. So are you starting to get into 4 down territory yet, the 12-minute mark? You're at midfield.
Knowing my offense, yes, I am. I think you have to take your shots and play to win.
They're going hurry up here, 3rd down and 8.
And that's how you, that depends the plays you call, too. Do I have 2 to get 8 or 1 to get 8?
Here's McGloin, and throws it away there. There was double coverage. Zerba, the intended receiver. Let's see. Penn State is going to bring on the field, or the punt team here. Try to pin Nebraska deep.
Well, he had Brown open, Dave. He took his eyes off the middle of the field. He had number 19, Brown, coming across the middle, wide open, right at the sticks. McGloin just wasn't patient and went to the outlet receiver a little too quickly.
Amir Abdullah is deep for Nebraska.
Thought Tom Bradley might have his first real difficult decision of the day, whether to go for it, but after the incompletion, you knew on 4th and 8 they weren't going to. And the kick is over the head of Abdullah. Penn State down there, and they could not keep it from going into the end zone. As you could hear in the background, chants from the student section for Jopa. And the Nittany Lions, with great effort downfield, many of them saying that they were going to try to win today for Joe. As you see, the ball crosses the plane and into the end zone. It will come out to the 20 when we return. Back at Penn State, where the Nittany Lions trail Nebraska by 10 early in the fourth quarter. An attendance of almost 108,000. For the most part, it's been a quiet crowd. The student section has been on its feet for a good portion of the game. As Nebraska runs the football on 1st and 10, and look at Burkett keep the legs moving and get the first down across the 30-yard line, dragging Nittany Lions with him.
I know that they altered his practice habits a little bit this week, gave him some rest, and he's running with renewed energy.
It's Burkett again, this time on a pitch. Jordan Hill hit him in the backfield, He tried to reverse field and ran into his quarterback. Gerald Hodges takes down Burkhead, a loss of a handful.
Right, I just still think, Dave, and I understand your point. This is what they do. But they're snapping the ball a little quick, and Burkhead's limping off the field.
So does that alter what they do with him out? The other three running backs that they play are all true freshmen. Here's second and 15. Martinez will keep, and he is across the 30, get back to the original line of scrimmage, and then got a couple of more, so it'll bring up a third down and about nine. What's the play call here for Nebraska? Do you want to keep taking time off that clock and run the ball? Martinez is at 50% completion rate. Burkhead is into the game because he was banged up a couple of plays ago.
I think you throw the football. You play to win. Martinez has thrown the ball well. He's made good decisions. Go ahead and take a shot or a quarterback draw here, which is a formation that they're in. Remember, they go empty to spread everybody out and let Martinez run it with his feet.
Play clock at three. It will be a pass. Martinez throws a low toss that's caught for a first down by Kyler Reed. So on third and nine, they get 12 yards.
Well, that's just confidence by Tim Beck and Bo Pelini in number three. Taylor Martinez. Kyler Reed goes down. Secure catch and a good throw by Taylor Martinez. Low and away, so his guy can only get it. Outstanding execution.
Nebraska, five of its last seven on third down conversions. Burkhead back on the field. And again, right between the tackles. Burkhead runs into Nittany Lion territory for 8 yards.
Well, this offensive line is really performing at a high level against a very good front four, the Nittany Lions. Sustaining blocks, moving people, and Burkhead is a one cut and done guy. That means he's downhill and downhill in a hurry.
Nebraska is a game behind Michigan State, tied with Michigan and Iowa in the Legends Division as they shift Burkhead under center. And LeGate fumbled the ball. Penn State's got it. The fullback, Tyler LeGate, lost it, went behind his back, and the Nittany Lions jumped on it. They'll have it at midfield.
Watch Devin Steele, number 71, who makes the play. The senior's been playing great all day. His team needs a play. Let's make one. Quick swim, penetration, disrupts the handoff between Burkhead and LeGate. Again, dangerous running that where Burkhead's not used to taking the snaps and handing the ball off. But still, stepping up like a senior, like the great player he is, trying to rally the troops. Now, Penn State offense has some field position to work with.
First time, really, they have had a short field. Gerald Hodges with the fumble recovery puts the ball at the Penn State 49, trailing by 10.
I promise you, Dave, Devin still knew that play was coming.
And officials are having a conference here. Nebraska might challenge. But usually when you see a fumble recovery in the middle of the field, you're not going to see replay overturn it unless you can clearly see the football. So that might be a wasted challenge, which would mean a wasted timeout by Bo Pelini if that's what he's thinking about here.
Out of six times that Nebraska's been in that formation with Burkhead at quarterback, they've run a little belly quarterback follow. And I'm not sure Burkhead tried to give it to LeGate. I think he was trying to hold it. But Devin still read it, penetrated, and was able to cause the fumble on the fake or the possible give.
Paul Pelini is upset with referee Scott McElwee. We'll see again what the reason is. Initially, you might be trying to challenge the ruling on the field.
The Nebraska coach was attempting to challenge the ruling of the recovery by Penn State. This is not a reviewable play. The play stands as ruled on the field.
Again, replay wouldn't even overturn that. It's in the middle of the field. You can't see where the ball is. It was ruled Penn State ball. So the Nittany Lions now, what do you expect here? Silas Redd has not played a whole lot. He's not in the game right now. His backup, Stephon Green, is there.
And they're going in shotgun formation, so they have to get something going with McGloin. I suggest a little short, little three-step hitch to get it going, or handoff.
Here's Green looking for running room. It's not there. Now, the other option is Rob Bolden, who's played in every game but has not appeared today. Do you go there if you're the coaching staff?
Absolutely not. He hasn't played all day. I think McGloin, watch the games on film that I've watched, watch them practice. McGloin gives them the best chance to be successful in this situation.
I still got 4 yards on that play, so that's a good play. Second and six. In Nebraska territory, Green will remain the tailback. McGloin under center. It's Green again, trying to be patient and find a hole. And he gets grabbed by Terrence Moore after a gain of two. So third down and four. They'll bring in a couple of extra receivers here. See if they spread it out. And again, we mentioned Jay Paterno, as usual, with Galen Hall upstairs calling the plays. But Tom Bradley has the final say if he wants to overturn something. On third down, they will run it again with Green, and he bursts past a Nebraska defender. They're going to spot him down short, though. It looked like he got it initially. One official said that he did, but the linesman is spotting his knee down short of the first down at the 42, and you've got to go for it, right?
Yeah, you saw right here. Green's knee does hit. But Cassidy comes up to make the tackle. Green runs through that.
Now let's see.
Right there. His hip and thigh.
Although where the ball is, it looks like it should be closer to the 41. They've got it actually spotted back around the 42. Now this is reviewable and something you can challenge the spot with respect to a first down. Again, it's where the ball is, not the knee. And it looked like the ball should be closer to the 41. If it is fourth down, well, hold on.
The previous play is under further review.
So they will review it. But even if they don't get it and it's fourth down, we'll see what Penn State does. Green, you see, keeping the balance there. The knee is down, but again, look where the ball is, closer to the 41. Here's the replay of Stephon Green. Now, the referee said that the ruling on the field stands, which means that they don't have enough video evidence to overturn the ruling that he was down at the 42. It looked to me, though, like the ball, maybe not first down yardage, but just short of the first down. Right here, he is a yard, if not a little bit more than a yard short of the first down. What's the call?
I think Brandon Beeching has been pretty outstanding as far as getting you tough yards, with Mike Zordich leading the way, number 9.
Here's Beecham, and he dives to the first down at the 40-yard line. Will Compton on the stop, but a fresh set of downs for Penn State.
A good lead block right there by Zordich, not to allow any penetration, just getting it away.
Chris, you could say that, oh, that was a tough call for Tom Bradley, interim coach there. No, it wasn't. He had to go on fourth.
It's the only call.
Yep.
See him congratulating Zordich there on that.
So first down at the 40-yard line for Penn State. We're inside 8 minutes to go, trailing by 10. And there's some confusion here about the clock. The play clock is at 25. And McGloin on first down. Hands off to Beecham. And he gets the 37, got 3 yards. Let's check in with Reese.
Today, very important game in the Big East. Cincinnati's leading that conference. Zach Collaros knocked out of the game with what is being called a significant knee injury. So Munchie Legault, one of the great names in college football, scores for the Bearcats. But West Virginia still up 17-14, going to the fourth.
And Reese, here it's a 10-point game, but Penn State driving. They came up with nothing the last two times they were inside the 40 in Nebraska. Beecham again, and is hit in the backfield. An offensive lineman got pushed back into the runner. Terrence Moore did the job there on the left guard, Johnny Troutman, and Beecham had nowhere to run.
Boy, I understand that you want to play it safe and hopefully pop one, but eventually to help yourself run, if you do want to run, you got to start throwing a rock on first down. Nebraska's in their nickel defense or their dime defense, which Penn State probably sees them more vulnerable against the run.
And again, no Silas Red. Don't know if it's because of an injury that he suffered in the first half, but he has not been out there in a while. Here's McGloin to throw on third and eight. And his pass is caught inside the 25, and Brown down to the 21 for a Penn State first down.
Dave, remember the last series I said he had Justin Brown open? They come back to the same play. You're going to see Green out to the flat. Brown right here in the middle. Watch Danny McGloin stay patient this time. Matt McGloin, excuse me, stay patient this time. And let him clear and throw to that window where he delivers the strike. That's a good job of coaching coming back to an open play.
Third catch of the day for Brown. And here comes a reverse, and Drake looking to throw it back to McGloin. First and goal from the five as McGloin makes the catch.
Give him a chance to take a shot. Right here, watch McGloin adjust to the football coming back. Nice. Securing the ball, making a little spin move, fight for everything he gets. I love the call. I mean, you're playing to win, you have nothing to lose, and you have McGloin coming back for the football.
Green, waiting, powers, touchdown! Stephon Green! The first time that Jay Paterno has smiled all week. You saw that big grin on his face. And Penn State now a point away from making it 17-14. And Farrah puts it through. .42 remaining. The Nittany Lions have come back from 17 down to pull within three on Senior Day at Beaver Stadium. After a Nebraska fumble at midfield, Penn State, thanks in part to a trick play. Only imagine Jay Paterno had a role in that, and probably the first time he smiled this week. He told us the other day he went 3 or 4 days without sleep when he accidentally fell asleep on the couch for a few hours. A lot of sleepless nights, not just for the Penn State coaches, but obviously the victims of these allegations and their families, but all the developments of the past week. Penn State now within three, 5:42 to play in the fourth, and the Nittany Lions kicking off. Abdullah and Marlowe deep for the Cornhuskers. And Abdullah had a little trouble with it. And he's grabbed at the 22. Let's check in with Tom Rinaldi down in the field.
Well, this sideline scene is packed with returning Letterman and former players, Dave. And when that score was made, this place erupted. You would think it was competing with the student section. And right now they are exhorting this defense. Well over 100 former Letterman who've come back to try to support this team after the week it's gone through, and they are as invested right now as anyone in this stadium.
All right, Tom, and you think of the Penn State coaching staff. Most of them are Penn State guys, either played for or coached here for over a decade, as Burkhead off the left side gets a couple. He usually, this half, has had running room, but that time bottled up for a two-yard gain.
Well, I'd like to see them give Taylor Martinez a run pass option. He's become dangerous, and he's making good decisions with the football. Smart throws and deciding when the proper time is to run. He's been doing it all day.
And now Nebraska taking time off the clock, where before they were going hurry up. Martinez will keep and get dragged down at the 28 by Stupar. Still, it's a four-yard gain, so third down coming up. Five to go for Nebraska.
Brandon K McKinney's been big on third downs as the year's gone on. Manuel also big on third downs. Taylor Martinez spreads the ball around.
Some confusion right now from the Nebraska sideline on who's supposed to be in the field and where they're supposed to be. They may have to burn a timeout here. The play clock at 10. Play clock down to 5. Martinez with 2. And here he is on third down. It's batted down and incomplete. Nebraska will have to punt.
Jordan Hill, 47, gets the big calls in the air. Again, recognition of a veteran defensive lineman, knowing you're not getting to the pass rush. Next best thing, get in the throwing lane and get palms in the air. See 47, big Jordan. Knowing he's not getting anything as far as penetration goes, has the vision to get in the throwing lane of Taylor Martinez.
Brown and Astorino are deep. Maher to punt. And it's a huge kick inside the 15, and Brown lets it go, and Nebraska downs it at the 11-yard line. 61-yard punt, and Penn State with the football and a chance to tie or perhaps take the lead when we come back.
The countdown to Euro 2012 continues.
What's it go?
Watch as Europe's elite battle for a coveted spot in the Euro 2012 finals. Don't miss Republic of Ireland, Estonia, this Wednesday live on ESPN. The superstars of the ATP are shining bright in the City of Lights. The ATP World Tour Masters 1000 continues from France with the BNP Paribas Masters. An unreal week of tennis has reached a dazzling finish with the draw down to the final two men. It's time to crown a champion in Paris. The BNP Paribas Masters. Men's final live tonight on ESPN.
Two scores in 5 minutes, and Penn State is back within 3 with the football. More college football action for you tonight on the ESPN networks and the big one on ABC at 8 Eastern. Stanford taking on Oregon. Andrew Luck and the Cardinal against LaMichael James and the Ducks. Penn State with a 1st and 10 on its 11. Silas Redd on a 1,000-yard back. Only got 5 carries this half. They're going with Stephon Green at running back. And McGloin to throw on 1st and 10. Everybody covered. McGloin slips, but didn't go down. And McGloin has running room up the sideline, and he steps out at the 16, picking up 5. He almost lost 5, but he kept his balance.
No panic in Matt McGloin. Working the pocket, trying to find time for his receivers. Nebraska's generating 0 pass rush. Matt McGloin can't sit back there all day. Good job of patience and poise to get positive yards.
Three and a half to go here in the fourth. They'll run Green. He's got a lane. First down to the 28-yard line. Gain of 11.
Penn State certainly can afford, David, to run there. Normal offense, run-pass mix. They're knowing Nebraska's playing that 2-deep shell. They're a gap short up front. They only have 7 men to cover 8 gaps. Penn State could exploit that on the ground.
Here's Green again. Brought down at the 37, a gain of 9. Keep in mind, Penn State has already missed a field goal, a 47-yard attempt. Anthony Farrah, the kicker, his long is 40. They do have a couple other kickers who have 43-yard made field goals this year. Still work to be done before that decision is made. Ball on the 36 of Penn State. They'll keep it on the ground with Green. And he's hit by Levante David for a loss.
Green, the ball carrier.
So it'll bring up 3rd and short. And they'll bring Silas Redd back into the game. Does not have a carry since the 12-minute mark of the 3rd quarter.
Green look a little gassed right there. That time Levante David did not hold his gap responsibility. Took a shot and he did meet Green in the hole, but he might come back to the same play.
And it's Redd with the carry, and he's cut down short of the 1st down by David. You got to go for it if you're Penn State, or do you kick it? You have three timeouts. What do you think, Tom Bradley?
I'm going for it. I think you got the momentum, the crowd. I understand. You have to go for it. He's taking a timeout maybe to discuss the issue. I think you got to go for it.
Well, if you're calling a timeout, you must be going for it, because otherwise you don't want to waste the timeout.
Well, you want to
right?
think about it also. Maybe they don't have a decision in their mind. Well, I go for it.
My point is, if they kick it now, then you only have two timeouts to stop Nebraska. They get a couple first downs, yeah. The game's over. So now you have to go it because you used that timeout there.
And again, I think Green was your guy. Now, Beecham's been their short yardage back. Zordich has been their lead back. You have to go to your money play or to your go-to play. Jay Paterno, Galen Hall will make this call. Tom Bradley will okay it. And Beecham has been the guy. Stephon Green's had the hot hand. And Silas Redd has been your guy most of the year.
And again, Tom Bradley has been in this position before. Back in 2006, when Joe Paterno was out because of an injury, Bradley ran the sideline. Galen Hall took care of the offense. And then back in 08, when Joe Paterno was upstairs for a lot of the games, and even recently, due to injury for a lot of the games, there was more involvement by the assistant coaches. But when it would come to this decision, it was always Joe Paterno on what to do here, whether to go on fourth and one. But Penn State down three will go. Fourth down and a yard.
And this has been the guy that will take you to the play. He's been a good lead blocker.
It's Red, and he's hit. I don't think he got it. Levante David made the stop. We'll see where they spot it, though.
It all depends on the spot. He needed just a couple inches past the 40, 38-yard line. Well, it's going to be close.
Initially, it looked like he was stopped short. The spot makes it closer. We'll see, though, if it's close enough to move the chains or if Nebraska takes over on downs.
I love the fact that Levante David came in high. A lot of times on short yardage, if you come in low, the back will just jump over you or fall over you. Levante David came high and knocked him backwards.
He didn't get it. It's Nebraska ball.
Nebraska ball.
Now they're going to review this further. Levante David with the initial hit right there. And again, it looked like he was short even there. But they will review, and it has to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the ruling in the field, which is he's short, and it's Nebraska ball.
That's a...
Chris, are you surprised at the play calls here on this drive, just handoffs?
No, not at all. I mean, I think that's how they were able to move the chains and score the touchdown. You see Coach Bradley. I'm not sure if he knows if they got it or not. They're reviewing the call, and right there it looks short. And that's a heck of a play now. He beat the center who was clean off on. Levante David beat the center, and he's able to have that speed. And again, I can't overemphasize enough as a coaching point. On short yardage, if you're a linebacker, you don't go low. You come high, because how many times, Dave, do we see when guys make tackle on short yardage, they knock them behind the first down marker, yet the ball carrier is able to fall forward right for the first down. That's a great job of execution and tackle.
After further review, the ruling on the field of the runner being short of the first down stands. First down, Nebraska.
So the video evidence not indisputable, but seemed pretty clear from what we saw that he was short, so it's Nebraska ball. Now, Penn State does have two timeouts. They got to stop them quickly and then force Nebraska to make a decision on third down, whether to pass and risk an incompletion or the clock stoppage, or just try to run the clock down. Here's Burkhead, and they wrap him up after he pushes the pile for an additional couple yards. So 4 yard gain, clock stop with 1:44 left. The timeout by Penn State, the Nittany Lions with one left.
Let me go over a coaching point that maybe is not given often.
Timeout in the second half. This is a 30-second timeout.
And it's tough to tell Rex Burkhead that once you get hit, I appreciate you fighting for extra yardage, but the more you're fighting, guess what? Your arm could come loose, and you have extra tacklers and gang tacklers coming in to strip the ball. Just make sure you emphasize. You can fight all you want, but have two hands on that football to protect it, because how many times do we see guys fighting for extra yards get the ball knocked out of their hands? That's just a point to emphasize this time of the game.
Now, we're looking forward here, but think about this now. If Penn State, they run the ball and Penn State stops them, it's third down. You have a decision to make on third down what to call. You may have a decision to make on fourth down whether to go for it, whether to try a long field goal, which would extend the lead to six, but it'd still be a one possession game, or try to punt the ball. Let's see what happens first on second and seven.
Thank you. Before I make those decisions, let's see what happens.
There's a lot in play here. Burkhead, and he pushes forward to the 31 for another three. So a timeout. Penn State with third down and about three. Ball on the 31-yard line. Now, if they run the ball here and don't get it, the clock will go down to about a minute before Nebraska has to make a decision for what to do on fourth down.
Well, here's a couple things that I'm going through in my mind if I'm defensive coordinator. I know I got to account for Burkhead. They just run two ISO plays to Burkhead. One play that if you're Penn State that you might want to be aware of is a little naked boot off of that. And what I mean is Burkhead fake him the same look for the past two plays, run him out around the edge because he has the speed to beat somebody. And if you get nosy, you might be able to catch him. Plus, it's a safe play. Then you have the decision depending on down and distance, field goal, punt, or go for it.
There's no way Penn State thinks Taylor Martinez is going to throw the ball. Would you take that risk here?
No, I wouldn't.
Penn State can't stop the clock. You can help them stop the clock with an incompletion.
Well, it's either Burkhead or Martinez off the boot.
Third down and about four. It's Burkhead. And he will not get the first down. He's about a yard short, so that'll take the clock down to about 50. Do you go for it on fourth and two if you're Nebraska? Do you try a field goal, or do you punt it and try to get Penn State inside the five-yard line?
I have confidence in my field goal kicker. I make it a six-point game, so they know they have to get a touchdown as opposed to the field goal to extend the game.
But you risk then a punt block. If you miss it, Penn State gets better field position. A field goal block. You risk that and then maybe a return. I think they should go for it, and that's apparently what they're going
to
do.
I'm trying to get points. I might think about the points because I want to make it a touchdown possession game as opposed to a field goal possession game. That's what I want to do.
So 54 seconds left. Bo Pelini takes a timeout. So they'll have more time to talk about this. It would be about a 47-yard field goal. And again, that's a huge risk. If there's a bad exchange and you fumble the ball, somebody picks it up, or the field goal kick gets blocked and you get a return.
From spring football to now, I practice field goal and the execution of the snap, hold, kick. I understand there's risk involved. Now, you cut a risk reward. The reward is you make it a touchdown possession game. If you miss the field goal, it's like getting stopped on fourth down. So why not go for the points? Now, it depends. Now, if you're trusting your offensive line, you got Burkhead, who's a tough kid. You got Penn State, who's going to sell out. And you try to end the game by going and putting them away. That's a decision that Bo Pelini makes. You're asking me right now. I trust my kicker to get the points.
Well, Maher is out there warming up, so it looks like they're going to do the field goal. No, now they pull him, and they're going to go for it on fourth down and one. If they get the first down, for all intents and purposes, the game is over.
Good watch the hard count now to try to draw him off sides. That's always in play.
Burkhead behind Legate. Martinez. Burkhead on fourth down, and he stretches out. The ball comes out, but they rule him down. And he appears to be short. Stupar on the tackle. The ball came out and was recovered by Penn State, but it looked like the runner was down.
Stupar on the stop.
And they're spotting him short, at least from that angle.
Timeout for a measurement.
So an official timeout. Penn State out of timeouts. If it's Nittany Lion ball, would have 49 seconds left.
Little surprised they came back to that play, Dave, since they didn't have success on it the previous play. Let's see where Burkhead is tackled. Long out there pulling out in front. Stupar does a great job of defeating one for one.
No, he's short.
Tripping
he's short.
Up.
Yeah, half a yard short. And again, the ball came out, but he was already down. This should be Penn State ball.
Again, I mean, I understand the call, but I just feel comfortable with them having to get a touchdown as opposed to a field goal.
It's Penn State ball, and it's 29-yard line. No timeouts. The clock will stop on first downs to reset the chains of the ball. For Penn State missed a 47 yarder in the first half. His long on the year is 40. Two other field goal kickers, Evan Lewis and Sam Ficken, have 43 yard made field goals this year.
And you know he has the distance from 47, so by going by that number, they have to get it down to the 30 yard line of Nebraska.
Right now they're at the Penn State 28. McGloin. Everybody covered, so a short throw in the middle of the field. That's a mistake there. You got to throw it away. They lose yardage, and the clock keeps running. Not a good decision by McGloin. And they're taking a lot of time off the clock here before running their next play. McGloin. And the pass deflected and incomplete, but a flag. So the clock will stop on the Nebraska interference call, but only 25 seconds remaining.
Deontay Evans got there a little early.
Holding defense. 10-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
So that gives Penn State 10 yards.
10-yard penalty brings the ball.
They're still at the 37-yard line, though.
Automatic first down. First and 10.
See that right hand. Deontay Evans pulling in.
25 seconds left for Penn State, no timeouts. McGloin going down the sideline for Moy, and it was thrown out of bounds. 19 seconds left. Double coverage out there for Nebraska.
Again, your mark is the 30-yard line, probably the 32. I think he had enough leg to get to the 50. 19 seconds. You can use the middle of the field. The clock will stop on first down. You also can ground the football on second down, which will be third.
McGloin started and has played the whole game. First time all year he's played the entire game. Here he is on second down. Clock ticking, and he's in trouble. Gets rid of it. Incomplete. 15 seconds left. Pressure by Baker Steinkuhler, and it's third down.
And here's what you have. Now, you don't have a lot of things open down the field. Line up in Hail Mary position, run to the 30, throw a jump ball. I mean, I think you have more success of getting that much yardage in that formation than you do running your regular offense at this point in time. I know that sounds a little crazy, but why not?
We saw a successful Hail Mary in a Big Ten game earlier this year, Michigan State beating Wisconsin. From the Penn State 37, no timeouts. 15 seconds left, and it's third down. Pass over the middle is caught, but short, and they can't spike it. It's fourth down. They got to get up there and run a play. It is fourth down and two. They cannot spike it. Four, three, two. McGloin gets the play off. This will be the final play. McGloin running around. And it's incomplete. Nebraska wins. A huge road win for Nebraska to pull within a half game of Michigan State for now in the Legends Division. An inspiring comeback by Penn State in the second half, down 17-0, and the Nittany Lion fans applauding the efforts of their football team despite the three-point defeat. Lisa Salters is standing by with the winning coach, Bo Pelini.
Thank you, Dave. Bo, the decision to go for it, fourth and two, instead of trying for the field goal, why'd you make that call?
You know, I just felt, I thought we could stop them defensively if it came to it. I thought we could end the game. And at the end of the day, I just thought there were too many bad things that can happen, a block, those types of things. And So I just thought it was the right thing.
Just saw a nice moment between you and Tom Bradley. What'd you say to him? It's been a tough week up here at Penn State.
Yeah, I just said good luck the rest of the way and hang in there.
What has been the biggest challenge of coming up here with your team, given everything that's going on up here?
Well, obviously, it's a crazy week, and you know it. You know, there are distractions when knowing we were coming up here and everything. And I thought both teams played well. I thought it was a hard-fought football game. I give every kid who played in that game a lot of credit.
Thank you for your time. Congratulations.
Thanks, Lisa. Appreciate it.
Tom.
Thanks very much, Lisa. Tom, with everything that surrounded this game, how do you feel your team performed today?
I was awful proud of them, the way they fought, kept fighting in the second half. I think it showed a lot of character, a lot of resolve by this team. And I like the way they stuck together, you know, down 17-0, hang tight and fought hard. And it, you know, we just got off to a bad start in the first half and took us a while to kind of get out of the cobwebs and get going. But we hung in there, and I'm proud of the way they finished.
So much has gone on this week. It's impossible to summarize it all. But how would you describe it?
Well, it was unprecedented probably ever in the history of college sports what went on here. And we are, you know, really, we grieve for the victims. We feel sad for the families, the children. I think they saw the student body today, the support that they had for the children and the victims that were all here today. And a lot of the things that went on today was all about them.
When you are with your team alone here, the first time you address them in the locker room, what's your message going to be to those men?
I'm going to tell them how proud I was of the way what they did this week and the way they hang together as a team and the way they stuck together as a family.
Tom, thanks so much. We appreciate the time. Dave.
All right, Tom. First loss of the Big Ten season for Penn State. Still two tough games left in the leaders division at Ohio State, at Wisconsin. Meanwhile, Nebraska still with the possibility of winning the Legends Division. Tom Rinaldi now with Jay Paterno at midfield.
Thanks, Dave. Jay, I just talked to Tom, and I asked him this question. So much has happened this week. How would you describe it?
Well, you know, we've had better weeks in our lives, obviously. And, you know, I think about a week ago where we were sitting, and the world's kind of turned upside down. But I think our kids were resilient. I think they had some really real challenges, and they stayed focused, and they played hard. And unfortunately, we just came up a little bit short. But we still have a lot to play for, and we're excited about what we can do.
You walk into this stadium, obviously, there's so many memories that swirl through it. It's defined essentially by your dad and by your family. What did you have to manage yourself in trying to coach through this football game?
Well, once we got here and the juices started to flow, I was focused. And you know what? That's the way we've been trained. Joe has always taught us about the blue line at practice. When you cross the blue line, the only thing you control is what you're doing right there. So we just had to imagine there was a blue line coming into the stadium. And once we were here, we were focused on the task at hand and just a little short.
I know you visited with your dad earlier today, your dad and Sue, and you wrote him a letter to try to deliver your message to them. Essentially, what were you trying to share with them, Jay?
Just how proud of them I am, and Dad, I wish you were here. We love you. Go.
Dave.
Tom, Jay told us yesterday as he was getting emotional in our meeting with him that in his conversations with his father, Joe continually said to Jay, we got to pray for those kids. We got to pray for those kids, not meaning his players, but meaning the victims in these allegations. And obviously that's affecting Jay, along with, of course, his father no longer being the head coach at Penn State and what the future holds for Jay and his family as well.
I look at Joe Paterno, and I would think that watching at home that he would have been proud of how his football team performed today.
They were down 17-0 late in the third quarter, but came back only to lose 17-14. A terrific road win for Nebraska to go to 8-2, 4-2 in the Big Ten. Penn State 8-2, 5-1 in conference play. 17-14 is the final. Nebraska wins. For Chris Spielman, Tom Rinaldi, Lisa Salters, our entire outstanding crew, I'm Dave Pasch. So long from Penn State. College football coming up next. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Now let's go to Reese Davis in the studio.